evening, everyone. Welcome to the Tuesday, May 2nd meeting of the Reading Board of Selectmen. Tonight, we will have Selectmen liaisons reports, a period of public comment, report of our town manager. We have a number of discussion items, including the expansion of a liquor license for Meadowbrook Golf Club. Fall Street Fair and Rotary Clubs will be in this evening. Reading Garden Club and Arts Reading will be in regards to flower sale. Climate Advisory Committee will be by to brief us on their report. Reading Ice Arena liaison report. RMLD Citizen Advisory Report member update. Housing Authority report. We've got on the schedule tonight an update from the working group that Selectman Berman and myself have worked with the Human Rights Resolution. We'll discuss an extension of the Human Relations Advisory Committee sunset date, and then we can talk about the assignment of liaison for 2017-18. We'll do an approval of minutes, and we will adjourn to executive session at the end of the evening to talk with respect to collective bargaining. Before I open, I did want to recognize a milestone, and on Thursday, we will send Paula Shenna off to retirement and welcome and thank her for her hard service. Paula, how many years total is this?
24.
Fantastic.
24 years of listening to us drone on.
48. Right?
And capturing the drone again in impeccable order.
And having tried to do it and failed miserably, I can only tell you, I don't know how you do it. So thank you very much for your service. It's in some cases, it's a labor of love, I know.
It is.
We're still only halfway. It can't, halfway
I know.
To
thank you.
Does she get assigned to
it? We'll see. With that, I'll open up for Selectmen's liaison report. I'm sorry, Paula, do you have any other?
No, that's fine.
I'll open up for liaison reports. Start on my left. Andrew.
So I don't have any liaison reports. I just want to make a quick comment since this is my first meeting in the flesh as opposed to a telephone. I just wanted to quickly thank the voters of Reading for coming out on April 4th. It's an honor to be elected, and Megan's going to take my picture again. And I just want you to all to know whether you voted for me or not. I hope to represent Reading and do you proud. And I promise that I am dedicating a lot of time to coming up to speed. And into the Board of Selectmen, and to Bob, I look forward to working with all of you and as well as the Town Hall employees.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you. Dan.
Two items, Mr. Chairman. As a follow-up to the Reading Elder Services Community Forums that were held last week, I had a prearranged phone call with one of the UMass Boston researchers that conducted that forum. I have kind of a combination of experience as a selectman and a member of a certain fraternal group in the community that she wanted to talk to me about. She asked a series of questions which will be part of the answers to which will be combined with others and reported back to. We talked about concerns the elders feel. I highlighted transportation as a key issue. She asked what one of the greatest impediments might be for the senior center to get its work done. I said volunteerism. I've noticed a drop off in volunteerism.
Really?
Sadly, in the last 30 years, I think there's a lot less of it in the community.
We just heard vividly about the amount of volunteer work that goes on there, right?
It is, and I think it's being shouldered by fewer and fewer people. Maybe not right there, but I'd say overall in our community, mm-hmm. our pool of volunteers, I've noticed that. So
okay.
That'll become part of the findings presented to the board.
Okay.
I also want to remind the community, we are in the middle of renewing our franchise contracts with, right now it's Comcast, eventually it'll be Verizon, there could be other players in the game before it's over. But the Town of Reading and RCTV Studios want to invite everyone to focus groups which are intended to explore community media, technology, and cable. They want to know your community cable-related needs and interests. There will be three focus groups on June 7th or 8th, 2017. And this is, I believe, available on rctv.org, so you can go there to get the details. If you want to save the times, there's a 3 to 5 slot on June 7th, There's a 1-3 slot on June 8th, and their locations are listed there. And actually, there's an evening one on the 8th as well. So come on, come on.
Phil, are those three, they're actually segregated by intent, but is it, can anyone attend anything?
Anyone can attend anyone.
Okay, thank you. And one other thing, before we continue, I see our microphones are gone. Are we back up on the ceiling now?
There, somewhere in the ether.
I actually don't have the answer to that question.
So we don't have any mute buttons tonight, is that correct?
No, I apologize for, you should have mics.
We have no mics.
Those are not mics.
Other than...
I would assume if...
That's a phone.
I'm sorry, I just got here, so I don't know.
All right, good. Eric?
Can I just ask a, Phil, were you planning on maybe doing one more evening session? Just seems like there's, would be a lot of people who may want to do it after dinner and some of one session after, you know.
Just the one on the 8th, I think, right now, scheduled.
There's only one scheduled as of right now, but if people RSVP will know how much time it's going to be, we could add another night one.
Okay, thank you.
That's all I have.
Can you send one more?
Oh, okay. Yeah, a few things. I actually attended the Climate Advisory Committee's Earth Day celebration at Parker. Happens to be my birthday. I always love to share my birthday with the Earth.
You're 29.
Which is great, yeah.
Are you that old?
4 million years old, yeah.
Billion.
So, yeah.
That's what it'd be.
So it was great. They had a number of different solar displays. They had a lot of the kids had assignments, basically to kind of go and find certain things which were at the event. RMLD was there selling. I got a bunch of light bulbs for like $2, that like $10 at Home Depot. So those people next year, you know, market. And it was a nice community event. They also, it was great. They had a number of solar. Electric vehicles in the parking lot, hybrids as well as complete electric vehicles that are so much more advanced now than the ones that you probably, you know, maybe have looked at. And they were pretty cool. And they had some of the representatives were there. So a nice event. They did a good job and really educating the folks on some of those sustainability issues. I also this weekend attended the Reading Educational Foundation fundraiser. REF probably raises and distributes close to $50,000 of technology to the different schools. Basically, teachers will write grants based on their technology needs, and that is $50,000 that's not coming out of the school budget. It's stuff that's completely raised by volunteers. They have a volunteer group of people who read the read the requests, and they hand out that money every year on a yearly basis. So every year they get more and more money, and the needs become more and more as the budget gets scrimped. So they're still doing an online auction. It goes to the end of this week. So there's still items that you can bid on, and that will go toward that. And also just another quick shout out. I got in the mail my contribution for the Coolidge Science Fair team. They have now won the state championship 24 times in the last like 30 years. That's better than the New York Yankees, the New England Patriots, the Montreal Canadiens, and the Boston Celtics. So they're trying to raise $50,000 so the team can go to the national finals in Dayton, Ohio. Again, another volunteer effort. Talked about sort of the dearth of volunteers. There's a lot of people. That's also stuff that does not come out of the school budget. That's all raised by volunteers, volunteer coaches. So. Again, if you see them outside a market basket, or you can just drop a check, they're trying to raise 50 grand in the next couple of weeks. So a shout out to the good folks at Coolidge.
Thank you, Barry. John?
Thank you, today.
Thank you, John. On April 25th, I attended the Reading School Committee standing meeting. The interesting part of the discussion for me was the revolving fund and extended day continues to grow, even though the balance has continued to grow, even though the amount of expenses allocated to the account has been increased. The school committee has taken the proposed step of actually reducing the tuition for the extended day. During the discussion, I spoke with Gail Wood, and it appears, at least according to what both of us can see on the web, that there's a provision to allow for capital and debt to take out of the revolving fund, which was news to me. But, so that would be interesting. It would be another means to provide an offset for some of those expenses in the revolving fund. And of course, I was with all of you gentlemen for three nights of town meetings, soon to be repeated, so. With that, we'll turn to public comment. If you wish to speak, please stand, state your name, precinct, or sorry, just your name and address, excuse me. Mr. Brown.
28 Mountain Road. First and foremost, I'd like to thank everybody for the wonderful night last Thursday night. And the sign is up in front of my property, on my property under the First Amendment right. Don't come up. Secondly, I would like to congratulate the two members of the sports selectmen. I will work with you if you need some help, any of you. Thirdly, it's been a long time since I've been down to you guys. Bob, the other evening alluded to transparency, we're going to keep going up and asking all the rights. One thing I have not heard is anything about the DPW site. Most of us know that it's going to be, what is the financial impact of that? I think that should be included in your transparency when you come out with the tax data.
That's fair.
Yeah, and I'm going to see what's the last one. Mr. Friedman, last, I think at your meeting, which I watched on TV, it was in North Carolina, so I don't know. Said something about the cemetery building and so forth. We have not made any decision on any site for that. That is up to the building committee to make a recommendation. I have my suspicion of what I'll end up being with that. And the Laurel Hill is definitely off the table because there's not enough space up there. And I somehow wish you guys would make a decision. Are we going to go with DPW or not? Because that building, nobody should be working in. Quite frankly, it was a chicken coop when they bought it, and it's giving the question now.
And the chickens are getting tired.
Nice.
I understand. Thank you, Bill. Mr. Tafoya.
Good evening, Ben Tafoya, Oak Street. I want to thank Selectman Ensminger. A number of us from Oak Street came in tonight to talk about our ongoing struggles with the MWRA and the gas company and the plan for reconstruction of the road and sidewalks as a result of the construction activity. Dan, Dan took great notes, and Bob came in, and we appreciate his input. And we just want to make sure that the board was aware of that we came in with the issue. There are a couple of residents of the Oak Street who came in for the selectmen's meeting who weren't present during office hours, who may have additional input to give. But I think Bob and Selectman Ensminger both got the message that folks on the road are frustrated by the construction process and a bit concerned about sort of how the reconstruction is going to go. And we're looking forward to the town's leadership to help make sure that it's a successful endeavor with dealing with the multiple parties.
So, okay.
And with that, thank you, Paula. Congratulations.
Bob, is there a forecasted date? Maybe that's the wrong term, but is there an estimated date of completion for?
Is there something in your package? We have our DPW department here, Jeff or Gene.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you back there, Jeff. Yeah.
Yeah, I think.
I shared Ryan's memo with the select on the
page
packet.
Page 5.
I'm not sharing with the group next door yet.
Okay, so I think scheduling wise, the project, obviously, you want to try to coordinate with the school closing, and you don't have to be doing the paving, that's why the school's still in session, so forth. So, but the first step would be the sidewalk, when the gas company had sidewalk, has to be done first, then it'll be completed, totally redone, and that could happen, hopefully, within the next few weeks. But again, it's still tricky with the schools. I mean, do you really want to get some sidewalk done with the schools? So probably not. So I would say, as soon as that's done, everything will be lined up, the sidewalks will be completed first, then the roadway construction right after that, with the MWRA having the contractor complete the paving. I know there's been a lot of frustration out there. I know Ryan, Percival, our town engineer, is in contact with both MWRA and the gas company almost on a daily basis. I mean, really trying to step up and coordinate all activity, as has been mentioned. I mean, you've got multiple contractors, and there's a lot of coordination has to be done. And I think it's the town's, role to step up to make sure that happens. And that's our plan, and we really will concentrate on that and make sure that happens.
Good. Bob.
Jeff, if I could ask a question, something that came up just next door was a little alarming. The gas company knows that it owns some of the sidewalks as part of the project, the MWRA owns others. I assume there's gonna be one sidewalk vendor that's coming in to do the repairs, and we're not gonna have a patchwork quilt.
Absolutely not, it'll be coordinated, it'll be one contract, that should be the one contract to have a complete, you know, straight job done, and not having one section done and another section done and so forth, I mean, it has to be coordinated all together, because that's the only way you're gonna get the quality work.
Thank you.
Any other public comment? Hey, how you doing?
Paul Barada from 44 Oak Street.
Haven't seen you in a long time.
I appreciate what you just said, because that was our major concern, just so you know, is that the street being dug up and the sidewalks, personally, from Pine down, Pine Crest down, and my sidewalk is a mess. And we're really concerned, because they still haven't really fixed it, there's still pieces of the sidewalk that are exposed to kids walking to school, riding their bikes, I've actually had two kids fall in front of my house on their bikes, so, you know, I really appreciate Dan and Bob listening to us, and I guess our biggest concern is that we just wanna make sure that when it's done, everybody's safe.
I understand, thank you, nice to see you again.
Thanks for coming in.
Good to see you too.
Yes, sir.
So Tom Lawton at 24 Oak Street, between Ben and the others. My concern is, I've heard a lot of information, and tonight I'm hearing another bit of information. So, I've heard from the contractor and others that they're only repairing the sidewalks that they cut through. So tonight, I think I'm hearing that they're gonna repair all the sidewalks, or am I not hearing that?
No, the sidewalks that was, that they put the gas company, when they put the line in, that's gonna repair it back to the same or better condition than it was, that section, only that section.
And the rest of the sidewalks?
That was not, it was not, well, not a part of, it wasn't a sidewalk job, it was a, obviously, a water install job and a gas main job, but the sidewalks that were dug up are the ones that are gonna be put back the same or better condition.
Okay, so my concern is that Reading, we don't spend enough money on roads, I think everyone in this room would agree on that. We probably don't get enough in Chapter 90 money from the state, and the opportunity to do this is really lost. So, I mean, I'm not an original person from here, but I've been around this town for maybe 35 years. I saw streets when I was here, you know, much, much younger, get chip sealed, and nothing's happened to them in 35 years, 40 years, it's kinda crazy. So, I'm afraid that this road gets done and nothing happens for another 25 years. So, the sidewalks that are there that did not get cut through, in some cases are in worse shape than the sidewalks that did get cut through, but now have a patch on them. So when will they get repaired, in 15, 20 years, 30 years? I also believe that there's a huge opportunity here to correct the deficiencies of Oak Street. Oak Street has drainage problems, Oak Street has horizontal and vertical geometry problems. It has high-speed vehicles that drive on it. I live at the bottom of the hill. Ben and others live at the top of the hill where the speed starts to pick up. If you come past Pine Ridge or Oak Ridge, the road opens up to a very unnecessary width that is inconsistent with the beginning of the street at West Street and the bottom of the street. People pick up speed, they hit the hill at Hillcrest, and then they start to brake. Hopefully, no kid is coming across out of Joshua Eaton or some other place. So, if we just rebuild any kind today, all we're gonna do is smooth the surface and increase speed. So, we've gotta do a consistent cross-section through the area that defines the space for users. This town has been big on complete streets. There's a lot of information that this town is promoting about complete streets. We're accepting money for safe routes to schools. We're trying to get grant money for complete streets projects through the state. We need to be consistent in what we do with projects as well. You know, there are good engineers in this job, FSMT, that knows what to do, how to do it. I'd like to see a set of plans. Yeah. I've been told the roadway is gonna be done full depth reconstruction. I don't know the method, whether it's gonna be reclamation, whether it's just gonna be torn up pavement and stuff like that. But full depth reconstruction requires a base to be put down, then a curb to be set, then the sidewalks to be built. You don't build sidewalks first and then do full depth reconstruction. That is not the way a road is built. And we will end up with a real problem if that's the way it is done. So I'd like to see a set of plans. I'd like to see a little bit more of a plan for the entire job and a little consistency in the roadway and a design that should be there, not kind of what's evolved over many, many years. So thank you.
Thank you. Jeff, with regard to that question, The current repair is strictly to patch the water and gas lines as they've gone in, or is there, is it accurate to say that there's a full depth reconstruction?
The road is gonna be reclaimed, there'll be full depth reclamation for the road, I understand the process.
It's reclamation.
So you take the machine and plane it, basically.
Yes.
And is it done in place, or is the material hauled away and combined with the bituminous and brought back?
It'll be, material will be taken out, and it'll be a new base put down, gravel base, and it'll be a binder that overlay, it'll be a total reclamation.
And it's done on site, or is that done offsite and brought back?
On site.
Okay.
Could I ask one more question?
Sure.
Will there be curb placed, there is no curb in an area maybe a couple hundred feet south of, or north of Oak Ridge, all the way down to Joshua Eaton School, there's this missing section of curb, and when you look at foot traffic going to the school, both for school, you know, kids itself, and little league Saturdays and Sundays, the parents going to the playground and stuff like that, that's the section of sidewalk that sees the most foot traffic. It all collects, and it ends up there to be able to enter into the school from Oak Street.
Is it a contiguous section of missing curb, or is it like a missing tooth kind of thing, where it's here and there?
No, it's a good, I guess I'd say 600 feet, maybe 500 feet, something in that length. But what ends up happening is lots of people come down the street for school activities, be it evening or drop off or whatever. They got one tire up on the sidewalk, trying to be off the road, not realizing that it's a one-way street during certain times of the day. They essentially just walk the sidewalk in order to get their vehicle up off the road and stuff like that. So a curb, again, defines that user's space. Where does the vehicle belong, where does the pedestrian belong, and how is the space used? And without the curb, it really is a safety issue. The curb would also slow vehicles down. The last thing people want to do is hurt their precious car, that's what slows people down. It's not the kid in the road, it's not the person walking on the side of the street, it's their vehicle they're concerned about.
At the project at the moment, Jeff, is that curb, that 600 feet of curb, is that excluded?
It's not in the current budget, I mean, the town has some money for curbing and sidewalk repair, and we can take a look at it, maybe, you know, if there's pieces that we can kind of make it contiguous going down, that would make sense to look at doing that.
I do know the West Street project ate into more budget than we expected in terms of curbing, so I know we're probably lean there that more than we expect. I'm sorry, was there a question in the back?
Well, my question was, a year ago when we had our initial meeting down at, I think with Joshua Eaton, we were told that the sidewalks and the curbing was going in by the old town engineer, and that was,
April 2, 2015.
Yeah, so we were under the understanding that the curve that's in front of my house, John, the curve that comes in front of my house where cars come down, and for some reason, because of the way the road is built, they actually come towards my house. So if you park in front of my house, you do it with, you know, knowing that you probably have a good chance of getting hit at times. And I was told there was gonna be curbing there, and what that was gonna do was gonna keep the cars so that they're not coming up my, whatever that lawn is, used to be.
Tree lawn.
Tree lawn, which is gone now, but they used to come up onto the tree lawn.
Okay, understand.
Somebody just needs to look at it.
I guess we'll go back and take a look at the original commitment and see what was actually said. Any other comment from the public tonight? Thank you. Bob?
Nothing, I realize we're just gonna report on Oak Street, but that's gonna be a full agenda. I think I may make some remarks at the end.
All right. We're a little running behind 10 minutes, so we've got the Meadowbrook Golf Club liquor license expansion discussion.
So I'd like to introduce Bob Morelli to the board for those that don't know.
Hey, Bob.
Bob's at Meadowbrook, and I invited him in. This is an informal step in what will become a formal process. Bob's just going to describe to the board quickly an idea he has for a change for his liquor license.
Good evening, all. As Bob said, I'm the manager of Meadowbrook Golf Club about 15 years. And during that time, we've seen a definite change in our demographic. We were trying to answer with some of the concerns that they have about the club's operation and so forth and so on. One of the things that has come up in the course of the last 10 or 12 years is the fact that we are not allowed to serve beer on the course. In most cases, that is allowed in the golf club. Either they buy it at the bar and bring it out, or they have a cart that that brings it out. So I've been thinking about a way that we could do it that's that a safe way and a way that we have control over what's consumed and who consumes it. So I thought of something, a beer cart or a beer and wine cart that we operate. All our service, by the way, are TIPS certified. And we operate on schedule. So it's something that would go out, let's say, we're thinking in terms of like 11 a.m. to 4 a.m. once an hour, or once every 45 minutes, or once every hour and a half. Since our club is no cash club, everything is billed to the members. So with that fact in mind, we always know exactly who's consuming what and how much they're consuming, so we have complete control over that part of the equation. So we feel it's a way to answer, or at least to attempt to answer, a question that's been raised to me for at least the last 10 years by our membership, which continually gets to be younger. When I say younger, they're, you know, 40s, 50s, 55, as opposed to when I first got there, our average age was over 65. So their expectations are a little different, and we just are petitioning the board at a future date to hopefully be able to allow that to happen. I am 100% open to working with the chief of police, who I've already spoken to, and the board, to if there's any desire to do it as kind of a pilot program where we can monitor it very closely, and you as well. You know, I have no problem with that at all.
Yeah, Bob, is this the situation we're empowered to license?
This is the informal step. The formal step is if and when Bob actually files an application. We have been in discussion with town council leading up to this, so we understand the process. Mm-hmm. This is actually, although it was new to me, it was not new at all to town council. It's a very common occurrence in many communities. The APCC already has a good process to follow for this, so it's not unusual. There's nothing different. It's just the usual notification period and hearing process.
There is a pretty detailed item on the internet with the Georgetown Country Club, which pretty much spells out exactly what the ABCC expects and what their parameters are.
Are any of your members under 21 years of age or not?
We have children who are under 20. Yeah. Children of members, yes. Okay. Yes, we do. Yeah.
Need to, obviously, not serve them out there.
Yeah,
people
well.
check IDs out there?
Oh, yeah, we do. Okay. Yes, we do. As I said, every server at Meadowbrook is TIP certified.
I'd be receptive to looking at it.
Okay. Questions from the board?
Is it another license or just a modification?
It's, as I understand, it's just a modification of the license. Where it's so different and somewhat unique, I would want town council present at a hearing.
Yeah.
They've already agreed to that. You know, at any of your future May and June meetings. And again, as Bob mentioned, and as he and I discussed, you know, if the club and the board both want to take this on as a one-year test to see what happens, that's okay. He's open. I think the town is open to try anything, basically, and see how it goes.
Well, it actually seems like it makes some sense. I just wanted to be sure we weren't going to burn another license to do it.
No, we won't. No, it'll be a modification.
In terms of public hearing, would we expect to sort of invite abutters?
I think in this case we, if you will, put the net out a little wider, and not just immediate golf club abutters, but go by streets. One concern town council had early that was worked out fine is whether or not alcohol service would cross any public ways. So some golf courses they would. In this course, you know, in this case, rather just have to be careful about that aspect.
Other questions? Andrew.
I have to, first of all, disclose that my son washes dishes at that kind of club, so let's get that out in the open. But I look forward to having a hearing.
Bob, you mentioned that currently it's no cash, it's done by billing members' accounts, is that correct?
And will be in the future as well.
And so you don't serve anyone that isn't a member by definition, no?
Well, if the member wants to buy that person a drink, yeah.
But the individual can't whip out a credit card and say, no cash? I would make one request, and I guess it's just suggested that you include in the application a couple of peer courses that do something similar, so just to give a set of comparatives that say, and I'm sure there are differences in how the implementation is, so it's more to look at where it lies within that space than anything else. So, if that's acceptable. John?
So, Bob, I'm assuming you still host charity golf tournaments, maybe on Tuesday? So, when that happens, of course, it's not members. How will you handle that?
Well, I mean, that's something that we really haven't, we only do two a year. We do the Reading Hockey and we do the Jimmy Fund.
Right.
We could approach that, either we don't do it at all, or we do it on a cash basis. In those instances. We don't like dealing with cash, quite honestly.
Yeah.
It's more an encumbrance than anything else, but, I mean, that could be a possibility. But the same rules apply. I mean, you know, we still, we have a complete control over who gets what and when they get what, so to speak.
Any other question? Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming in.
Thanks, Bob. We'll be in touch.
Thank you.
Next we have the Fall Street Fair Committee and Rotary Club.
I'd just like to make a few introductory remarks and then turn it over to Brian Snell.
You guys want to come up front?
There's a lot of them.
Oh, Brian.
As the board knows, there's been actually now a couple generations of Fall Street Fair. Come on up, Brian. Here, sit here. Of Fall Street Fair volunteers. This has been one of the most successful things, I would say, that Reading undertook. It was done initially just as a one-year celebration of fixing the downtown. It was so successful, I remember Steve Goldie saying, oh, let's try it a second year. It's still going on. The Rotary Club has expressed interest in partnering with the Fall Street Fair. And actually, at a recent meeting a month or so ago, I was at, voted, the Fall Street Fair Committee voted to turn it over to the Rotary fully for this year, which was not necessarily on my horizon that quickly, but it certainly would make great deal of sense. Brian serves as the chair of both the Fall Street Fair Committee and the Rotary, which was handy. But he was very clear to disclose what his interests were, and that was Fall Street Fair Committee purely. The only other thing I'll say is that in order for this to work smoothly, where I left it with Brian and the members was, I would think that dissolving the Fall Street Fair Committee as soon as possible would be helpful, because then they would no longer have to abide by open meeting law and post meetings. It's, you know, the same people doing the same work, just in a less formal way, I guess I'll say. Mm-hmm. So at that point, I'm really quite happy. I did mention at town meeting last night that this is a financial issue for the town. We are turning over some costs to the Rotary. Quite honestly, we're foregoing a lot more costs that we ate in the past that we will not put on you, because we will not, for instance, have a police officer at all your planning meetings. We'll only have them when it's a public safety issue specifically. So the town's participation will be less, and the budget impact will be less, and it's just one of the difficult choices we had to make. But I'm really very happy that it's not going to be a cut in service to the community. I think it's going to be the same Fall Street Fair that it's always been, and that's what everyone wants. So, Brian.
Thank you. You stole my thunder, though. I don't have a lot to say.
Sorry.
I did come with members of both the Fall Street Fair Committee. Currently, there were some prior members of the initial fair committees that stepped out of the room earlier. And I've also got some Rotarians that are here with me tonight as well. As Bob said, I've been the chairperson for the last three fairs. This would be my fourth fair, and it will be the ninth fair that the town holds. I'm also the incoming president to the Rotary Club, so as I kind of thought I was shaking this off when it all started, it doesn't appear that that's going to be the case. I think that the idea was that we're gonna try and grow the fair, so hopefully, it'll even be something that we're even more proud of. One of the biggest concerns that the committee had was that, the Rotary Club wasn't gonna come in and raise all sorts of fees and make the fair a different event that caused, individuals who would otherwise no longer be able to afford the registration costs, and we're not going to do that. We're going to keep the fair costs as close to what they are currently. A modest increase will be made. We haven't made increases in fair fees for at least 2 years, so I think it'll be a fair approach to the
no pun intended.
People a fair approach, exactly. I don't know what more you'd want to know, but we have, the Rotary Club has started to meet. We've actually got, I think that Sheila and Leslie, who are here with me tonight, we would acknowledge that we probably, the fair committee has been comprised of 5 to 8 people, and that's who has put the fair on for the last 8 years. This year we have the Rotary Club, which has already got 3 times that dedicated to it. So we're hoping that we're gonna be able to use that manpower to create a much better event.
Mm-hmm. One question I would have is, in an environment where Rotary manages the fair, what will be the vehicle of communicating things like proposed changes, expansion, changes in fees? It's not necessarily necessary, but more coordination and awareness. With the town?
I guess there wouldn't necessarily be any kind of communication with the town. It's going to be a Rotary event, a privately held event.
Okay.
We're going to get a permit from the town to hold the event. We'll communicate the information in the same way that we always have, is through the website to the participants that are in the fair. So I don't see us coming before the Board of Selectmen ever again.
And Bob, adding, I'm making this up, obviously, if 25 or 50 more attendees or booths showed up and the requisite space were allocated, that just happens through the normal channels.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The other thing I think is worth mentioning is that I know in the past we've spoken to some of the sort of one-man shops, one-man food establishments, for instance. They don't have the staff to participate in a Fall Street Fair, but they would love the publicity. So the Fall Street Fair Committee created a process whereby sponsors could be had, and then someone, perhaps a nonprofit group that wanted to be there with a table that couldn't really afford the table fee, if you will, they were a natural partnership. So, you know, I look forward to more creative ideas that government doesn't always think of.
I'm sure. So this is daytime government handing it off to the citizenry, right?
Yes.
So the baton has been passed.
It has, and so with that, I think we're looking for the Board of Selectmen to formally disband the fair committee so that we can continue to bring the fair in a more or a less restricted environment.
Is there any outstanding business that the Fall Street Fair has pending that requires them to remain standing for any length of time?
I would say no.
Yeah, none that the town accountant was aware of as of 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Is there any reason to postpone a vote to another date?
No, and I'm sorry I didn't put it in your packet, I wasn't sure, but move to sunset the Fall Street Fair Committee effective today would be the appropriate motion.
I'll make that motion.
Just for the record, they were scheduled to sunset next fall after the Fall Street Fair.
So you guys beat your own schedule.
Actually, I think we were scheduled to sunset at the end of December, because we knew that we were, I think we came before the Board of Selectmen a few years ago and asked for through the end of 17.
I love it, on cost and ahead of schedule.
Very good.
All right, we have a motion Dan has put into play. Do I have a second?
I'll second it.
Any further discussion?
I have a question.
Yes, Barry.
So as I understand it, if I wanted as a citizen to volunteer to be on the Fall Street Fair, do I have to join the Rotary in order to do that?
So one of the things that we've come up with this year is called a service membership to the Rotary Club, whereby individuals will be able to affiliate with the Rotary Club, participate in service projects, and attend one meeting per month, in contrast to a typical member, which would attend 4 meetings per month.
So, if there's like the planning is going on to put the fair on, you might be meeting weekly, like up in, you know, in let's say August, early September, I can only go to that one meeting a month, or can I?
No, the meetings per se that are associated with the Fall Street Fair planning, like subcommittee meetings and the fair meetings in and of itself, are in addition to whatever other, that's part of the, that's the service, if you will. The Rotary Club meets on Mondays at lunch at the superintendent's office, and we're going to be having a monthly social that will happen in place of one of those Monday meetings. So that's the one meeting per month that a service member could attend. They could also attend a daytime meeting, but usually the reason they're not in the Rotary Club to begin with is because those daytime meetings are hard to make. So for the first year that people participate in this, we're offering that service membership at no cost. And if they're enjoying their experience with the Rotary Club, our hope is that they'll want to become a member.
Right now, if I wanted to be on the Fall Street Fair, I don't have to pay a fee to volunteer.
Well, that's true, but the Rotary Club does a lot more than the Fall Street Fair. And it's because of the fees that we charge our members to participate that we're able to do the things that we do, like running the snack shack and doing the Taste of Metro North and the various other events that we participate in.
No, I think it's a great idea. It's a way to kind of expand and really stretch the kind of the volunteer hours. I just don't, what I would hate to see is someone who potentially wanted to volunteer sort of limit, having it go to the Rotary limit the number of people that could volunteer or limit those opportunities. So that's
I don't think that we would be in a position where we would prevent somebody from stepping forward and being able to volunteer simply because they didn't want to spend the money on any kind of a dues situation. I think what we would look at is ways to provide scholarships or ways to think outside the box, I think is what we would probably try and do.
Any further questions?
John,
public questions from the public.
Hi, I'm Sheila Mulroy, and I'm a current member of the Reading Fall Street Fair Board. this will be, at least for this first year, true collaboration, because a number of the people on the Fall Street Fair Committee will be taking the Rotary up on the opportunity to, at no charge to us, to join the Rotary, and so for this year it will be a true collaboration because many of us are will be involved still. Bob, you brought up a very good point about where we did try to have sponsors. We just didn't have the resources to go after those sponsors, and as you know, we were flat out and. Of course, the other issue has always been
open meeting laws,
and it's during the summer. Everybody's going on vacation. Yep. We really struggled a lot of times to have a quorum. The Rotary, to us, was the perfect people to pass our precious baby off to,
yeah.
because the philosophy is the same. It's a service organization. Our biggest concern, as Brian said, was increasing the vendor fees so much that the mom and pops that really are the essence of the fair would be pushed out, and we'd have just the people who go to every fair every year, and which would not make the Reading Fall Street Fair unique.
I just want to thank the Fall Street Fair Committee for growing their baby up to this age, and don't think of this as handing it off as much as it's going to college. Any other public comments or questions? Board members? Bob?
I'd like to thank Jen, especially, and her predecessor, John Feudo. This was really a very collaborative effort between a lot of parts of government, the organization, and the residents. And from that perspective, it really is not going to change. The same type of people will be involved. It's just a different structure, and honestly, you're now freer to operate, as you mentioned. Your hands won't be tied in any way.
Probably the best example of a public-private kind of partnership, getting the best of both worlds, and now it's kind of outgrown its shell, which is a good thing. Good. So we have a motion on the floor. It's been seconded. Further discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Congratulations.
Thank you. We'll make you proud.
Okay.
Okay, we're about 12 minutes behind. We have the Reading Garden Club and Arts Reading.
Come on up, Dick.
Come on up, see your seat.
Call 1 minute.
Whatever you're comfortable doing.
I'm sorry, why don't we take 1 minute, let the room empty?
This is, I'm Mary Ann Higgins, and I'm the vice president of the Reading Garden Club, and I'm here with Jean Stewart, who's in charge of the Ways and Means Committee, and Brian Kimmer, who is with Arts Reading. And we're here today to talk about the Geraniums and More plant sale, which is our major fundraiser of the year. And it's going to take place on Saturday, May 20th, on the Town Common. And it starts at 9 o'clock and ends at 1 o'clock. We will be having bake sale, geraniums, annuals, herbs. It's going to be, we're having hanging baskets, vegetables, and something that people love. They're called members' plants. Our members dig up their gardens and share with the public all of the perennials that have been so successful in their garden. And we know they grow, so you'll have a chance to purchase some of those plants. And we have a bake sale as well. And our site on the Common is, we've moved there from the library. When the library underwent construction, we moved to the Town Common. And I want to take this opportunity to thank Bob and all the other people that, and Matt and many, many other people and in government that helped us do that move. We really appreciate it, and it's worked out so well. And the DPW, I think the gentleman's left now, but the DPW is great. We also have the Boy Scouts helping us with the setup and taking down of all the tables and tents and so on. And as this is our major fundraiser of the year, you might be saying, well, why do you have to raise funds? And we have a long list of things that we do in the community, and that's really our purpose of fundraising. We do the Adopt an Island program. We're the liaison between the people who adopt the islands and in the town government. We maintain the gardens at Town Hall. I don't know if you've noticed them as you've come in here. We love how they look, and I hope you do as well. We are also taking care of the cherry trees at the train station. I don't know if they're in bloom right now, and they're just beautiful. We've planted a native tree in every schoolyard in Reading with the schools that would like to participate. We provide a college scholarship for Reading's students. And we have supported the Reading Open Land Trust. We're affiliated with Mass Horticultural Society that is at Elm Bank and Wellesley, and we're also part of Mass Grow, which focuses on promoting the use of native plants and drought-tolerant plants, so that our gardens, wherever they may be, are more attractive to bees and butterflies and so on. Jean is going to talk more about that in a minute. So those are some of the things that we do. And we also go to Daniel's Nursing Home and Artis, the new memory.
Artis Senior Living, yeah.
Yes. And do planting activities with the residents. And we provide a linen drive for Mission of Deeds. And every month we collect for the Reading Food Pantry. So we do a lot. And we are all volunteers. We do a lot for the community. And we're very happy to do so. So, I want to talk about the plant sale. We have, as I mentioned, all the different things that we're going to sell. But part of the common is also going to be taken up by Arts Reading. We are associated with Arts Reading as well. And Brian will speak to Arts Reading after Jean speaks. And we are so happy that they've joined us on the Common. They are going to showcase what they're about, and all of the members, some of the members are going to do demonstrations. So, are there any questions?
Last year, during your event, do you have any sense of the turnout or the number of persons?
We had much more turnout than we had at the library. The site is seen by people just driving through and they stop, and it's...
Do you count heads, or do you have any way to measure the...
No. I can't tell you, but I know money, I can tell you money-wise, we did a lot more, we've made a lot more profit than in other years. Yeah, it's a terrific site.
Very good, thank you. Andrew?
A couple of questions. Yeah, you do a bang-up business, it's like Filings Bargain Basement. Trying to get the plants.
On your wedding.
What?
Nobody knows what that reference is anymore.
That's sad, that's just sad. What was the date, May 20th?
May 20th.
Okay.
Yeah, May 20th, from 9 to 1.
I'll try to get the word out as well. Unfortunately, we'll be in at the Normandy beaches around that time, so I will, we'll miss it, my wife and I.
Okay, well, we'll think of you. Yeah, this will be on Facebook, and you'll see this actual poster placed all around town this next week, and so on. One important thing I have to mention, we're going to do an experiment. We're going to try using that little device that you've seen people use called the square, so that we always just do cash, but we know that as Joe mentioned, lots of younger people only carry credit cards or debit cards. So we have missed a lot of sales because we only take cash. So we're going to try it. One of our cashiers is going to have that device. So people this year, people for the first time can use credit cards.
You buy more with credit cards.
Well, we did think of that here. So, yeah, they'll be buying more.
You will also pick up some of the geraniums after the veterans are...
You know, we do tell our members that, yes. You want to tell everyone about that?
Yeah, there's 2,000 of them. Yeah. Anybody's welcome.
Oh. Okay.
We pick up the geraniums at the Laurel Hill Cemetery. What do you call them?
Two weeks after the chicken coop.
The chicken coop, yeah.
It was. Yeah. You're welcome to them. We're glad to have them. People have them, yes. And throw them out.
Yeah, that's really a good thing to let people know.
And if they want to make a donation to Flower Fund, we would appreciate that too.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Gene Stewart's going to... Oh, Matt, did you?
No,
go right ahead.
Oh, I'll be quick. One of the things we're adding on to the flower sale this year is ordering more native plants. Native plants, I think that's a term that people are hearing more and more now. And basically what it means is that plants that were here before we were here, the plants that were really local before we interfered and started bringing in plants that have been engineered to have certain colors, certain leaf shapes. The native plants are the ones that really supported the population of bees, butterflies, bats, insects, and that whole ecosystem was damaged somewhat when all of the new plants came in and replaced all of the ones that all of those creatures needed to survive. So what we're starting to do now is offer more native plants at the fair. Plant sale, I'm calling it a fair, somebody else was talking about a fair. And as I said, it's new for a lot of people, but I think what we're trying to have people understand is that you can plant a combination. It doesn't have to be all native plants or all the more elaborate plants. If you balance the mixture, then you're going to increase the butterfly's ability to lay eggs and the larva to produce and the bees to pollinate and the birds to do what they need to do to improve the environment as well. So that's one thing that we're going to really start emphasizing. The other thing that we've been very fortunate with is the groups from Arts Reading, particularly Creative Arts and the library, the town library, they have been supporting us with activities for the kids and information for parents and people on the common during the plant ceremony. So in addition to that, we'll also have some more information out for people, because there's so many plants that are so gorgeous that would look lovely in your yard and have been overlooked because they're old-fashioned perhaps, and as I said, they're not the new sharp colors, but they will grow and they will flourish and they will help all of the insects and the bees and the butterflies. The more insects you see, the more butterflies you see, the more bees you see, the healthier the environment's going to be.
Dan, could you give some examples of those native plants and species?
Oh, have I got lists for you?
Oh, boy.
One site you can go to is...
For a reference.
GrowNativeMass.org is one good site.
GrowNativeMass.
I have lists that will give you...
Okay.
Native plants that attract pollinators, that attract butterflies, that attract bees, that attract lava, hummingbirds, you name it. There are trees that will attract them, there are shrubs that will attract them, there are plants that will attract them. I'm going to try to give you some that you would actually recognize. Plants that attract butterflies could be alyssum, bee balm, asters, butterfly bush, daylilies, delphiniums, dianthus. The list is here.
I mean, that's just through the D's.
That's right? Just for the big one.
Yeah.
And then there's another whole list that will support lava development. And a lot of them you've heard of,
right.
Hollyhocks, milkweed, thistle. They tended to be plants when I was younger. That's what was in your yard. Plants that attract hummingbird. A lot of them you'll hear again, bleeding hearts, canna, coral bells, columbine, cleome, dahlias, delphiniums. There's just lists and lists and lists and lists. And you can find them if you Google anything that says plants that attract pollinators. You'll come up with lists that would really be helpful. So when you're looking to buy plants, it's always good to try to find some of those plants. We just got a little email from the Federation, the Garden Club Federation, that apparently some stores are trying their hardest to provide plants that will be beneficial to butterflies, but there's a chemical that's being put in them that kills the butterfly larva. So it's, you have to read your tags. I think the name of it was
one and done?
Systemic neonicotinoids or something like that. But read the tags, because sometimes people in the interest of trying to improve the environment forget that some of the chemicals are really going to not help it in the long run. So again, we're looking forward to a great day. We are crossing our fingers that it won't be raining. But we'll still be there. And we look forward to seeing you all there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Arch Redding. I'm here to represent Arch Redding, Brian Timmer. And I brought a graphic because the picture's worth about more. This is our banner that has our logo on it.
There you go.
And what we're trying to do is bring together all the cultural groups.
Why don't you come right up here and reverse yourself for a picture?
Yeah, the camera would
Steve.
Actually be able to see it. Sure.
Okay.
We're
trying to bring together the cultural groups. The end goal in the distant future is a cultural district, which came out of the study they did in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see this at the plant sale and probably Friends and Family Day. So we're trying to brand ourselves. This is our logo. It's based on the map of Reading with some colorful darts coming into the center of town. And our current situation, our status is that we are looking to become a 501c3, and we are currently having a fiscal sponsorship through Creative Arts in order to get some donations in. It's currently, well, we have a zero budget. It's funded by us, and we're looking for donations, and we get the nonprofit status, it'll be easier. We have a website, which is here on the banner, artsreading.org. It has a calendar on it, and we're getting more and more submissions from our member organizations to put their events on the calendar so that you can just go to one place and find out what's going on in town. So that's the quick summary. Are there any questions?
I'm curious. I know I've been reading about this for a while. Can you talk about some of the efforts that you've done to sort of, I mean, there's probably two or three dozen different arts groups in Reading.
Yes.
You know, sort of all independent of each other, doing different things, music, theater, you know, drawing, you know, all that kind of stuff. Can you talk about some of the efforts that you've done that kind of sort of bringing those people together so, you know, kind of give you a greater visibility and a greater, you know, presence? And then sort of, is there kind of an end game that you sort of envision?
Okay, we do have a monthly meeting, and all groups are invited, and we collaborate. For example, we are collaborating with the Garden Club. I'm in the library. I was talking to Amy, the new director, the other day, and I'm trying to get artist demonstrations in the library. I will be demonstrating in June myself. They're very excited about that, and we're working with Creative Arts. They have our sponsorship, so it's an informal group at this point, but we are just sort of getting together with people and needing to bring it together. The end goal would be a cultural district, which is a very ambitious sort of thing to do.
Yep.
One of the problems with that is we do not have a venue.
Yep.
If we had a venue, I think it would be a lot easier to bring everybody together and make it happen in a unified way. Did that answer your questions?
Yeah,
you did.
Yeah. You've given a lot of the details, Brian. Jesse Wilson began sort of this effort with the idea of should the town head to becoming having a cultural district, and if so, where? Early on, the group challenged when we said, how can town government help you? They challenged us with find us a building for free.
Right.
We said, nobody does that. Then Wakefield did that. We're still not sure how. Because I was sure, oh, they didn't really do that. They really did.
Yeah.
They found an unused or underused town building, and that's what they use. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I think it's the old electric office.
I think that's right.
Oh, on North Avenue?
It's on Albion.
Oh, yeah. Oh, right.
Yeah,
right, right.
It's the Albion Center now
yep.
for Arts or something
yeah.
like that. I think Wilmington has one as well.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
Let's get our MLD out of
here. Maybe, you know what? Why don't you just take this building?
Okay. So
please. Yes.
Thank you. Very good. Any other questions? Thank you.
Thanks.
Any questions from the public before we move on? Okay. Next on the agenda is the Climate Advisory Committee.
I'm the chair of the Climate Advisory Committee. Introduce a couple of our members here. So Gretchen Latowski is our newest member, and Gina Snyder has been a longtime member, is currently associate member. And I'm going to give you a little status of, you know, what we've been up to and what we're doing. So here's our members. Ron D'Addario, Gretchen, Ray Porter, Lorianne Sylvia, who represents RMLD as well. And our mission is not changed in a very long time. We are, you know, a citizens committee here. We actually have a number of people who work with the committee who are not either members or associate members, but nevertheless will help out at times, working on sustainability and environmental issues. And with this committee is coming. We have a sunset clause that's coming up at the end of June, so we're hoping that you will, you know, re-up the committee and establish that. I don't know if that's something for this evening or when you're planning to do those kinds of things, but it's important to us to keep going because we've got several things in progress. So some of the things we've done recently include the Earth Day Fair, which was held at the Parker Middle School. We had 22 exhibitors, including a number of the other town committees, some of them like the Town Forest and Trails and Walkable Reading, RMLD, of course, who's been an important part of that Earth Day Fair for many years. But this is the first year that it wasn't at RMLD. So before, we had always held it at the RMLD's properties, and this year we went to Parker Middle School, which worked out extremely well for us. Really appreciate the help that Parker Middle School gave to us, and particularly Mark Mahoney, who's the head custodian there, was real help to get things organized and provide us some resources and especially things like reserving space in the parking lot for electric vehicles. We had a number of electric vehicles on display in the parking lot there. There's a wide variety of things here. Doyen's was here, you know, Home Depot, DPW was there, and as well as solar, you know, vendors and geothermal vendors, and you know, so it was a wide variety of things. We had about 80 people attend. I think we didn't keep a good count, but we did have some people signing up when we got to the bag ban issue. We had a bunch of names for that, but it's probably about 75 or 80 people that actually attended this thing. That doesn't count the soccer players that came by the electric cars on their way to the.
Didn't have the Tesla this year?
We did not have the Tesla this year, but we had five of them there.
Yeah, the BMW.
We had two BMWs, actually, yeah.
Electric BMW.
Yeah. The cheap one.
Yeah.
The 42,000 one.
Yeah, there you go.
and the expensive one. We had a number of other things go on. We have a weekly Green Sense article that's published in the Chronicle and the Advocate, and Gina writes that almost all of the articles for Green Sense have been written by Gina. And we had a couple of appearances on RCTV in the middle of last spring. We had the bike swap at RMLD last year, and that's coming up. So the next weekend, this coming Friday and Saturday, will be the next episode of the bike swap. And this is where you donate a bike if you don't need it, and you pick up a bike if you want one that's maybe this new size for your children or adults, for both children's bikes and adults. So a lot of people go through old, you know, cycles with bikes.
How many bikes did you dispense with?
Last year I think there were about 60.
Oh my goodness.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. There's a lot of 60. Bikes left behind.
Mm. Well, you know, they turn them over. You know, you can upgrade, if you will. You know, you can donate a bike and then you get a
BMW
priority on a new bike, or you can just come and get a new bike, and then they give them away. I mean, whatever's left over, they give them away. So this year we actually got a bunch of bikes from the police department, right? We got,
oh,
yeah, police. I don't know why. I don't know where they got them, but you know.
Very strong criminals.
Yeah. We've got new educational materials on our website, environmental issues, particularly material that's suitable for children. We put up on our new website. We also sponsored this Before the Flood video back in January. We had about 30 people turn up for that at the library. The library has been a really outstanding place for almost anything you want to do, right? It really worked out well because of the connection. This was a live feed. This was a video that you couldn't get the DVD for. All you could get was the live feed, and so having that, the library facility was really, really helpful, talking about the issues around climate change. We've implemented a number of new social media capabilities. We had the town website, we always had that, and Paul has been a real help with us on the website and getting it updated. But we've now added a Facebook page, and we have another website where we can store, you know, just post materials like the educational material, things that are linked from Facebook and so forth. And we also established this new email writing climatecommittee@gmail.com. So if you want to communicate with the committee as a whole, you know, you can send it to this address. So we will be making that. That's going to be more of our advertising going forward, is what these social media connections are. This was we got a lot of help from Jackie Lerman. I don't know if you're familiar with the library's Net Guides. Is their teen Net Guides program. They recruit high school students to help out with these kind of issues, you know, social media issues, online type issues, and Jackie Lerman was the one who helped us, and she was very valuable because at the time our committee doesn't have that kind of experience, you know, so it was really valuable. She helped us to put it all together, and I think it was neat that the library even has this program. Solar energy. So this is just to kind of give you a status. The chart in the upper right there, this is a list of solar installations in the RMLD area and in Reading in particular. So 22 residential installations in Reading. This is where people are putting solar panels on their roofs. We don't have any commercial installations, but we have, you know, approaching a third of the residential installations here. And also, and then the, you may have heard, probably have heard of the Solar Choice Program, where RMLD has built a solar farm. It's in Wilmington, and has sold shares to its customers. And this, and these initial, this initial installation is a 1 megawatt installation. Each share, there's 500 shares. Each share gets about 250 kilowatt hours per month from this, from this solar farm. And it actually just started up the first of May. So there's a $5 fee for this, and then you get some rebates from you know, the RECs and so forth, the renewable energy credits and things like that. It's not a big investment. It pays back like $300 over a 10-year period or something. So it's not about the money. But if you are interested as a subscriber or a customer of RMLD, you can buy into this. What it, so where they are, they've got 567 people signed up for the 500 slots for this thing, right? And of that, you know, 246 are Reading residents. So half of the, so although we've got four towns involved in this who could be signing up, and half the people who are in fact signing up are from Reading. So now RMLD is off to establish the second one, which will probably still be this year. The next installation will be 1.6 megawatts, have 750 participants. So they're off recruiting, you know, new subscribers for that. And the way this works is the benefits are kind of shared around. So Wilmington gets a property tax on the value of this solar installation. The site owner, the one that's hosting the solar farm, is getting a rental, a lease payment for it. And then everybody else, you know, then the people who actually install it, they're getting the solar energy credits, the incentives, and the renewable energy credits, and we, the customers, are getting the solar energy. This is part of RMLD's effort to their Shade the Peak effort, you know, so that whatever we can produce with solar energy, shade, you know, just cuts that peak price when the, in the middle of the summer when energy use peaks, so does the price per kilowatt hour. So this is part of that effort. We're proposing to have a Reading project to look for possible installations in Reading. I've talked to Bob about this, how we might set this up with a citizens community committee with some consultation by town staff. But what we're suggesting is that we could actually establish a solar farm and same as this business in Wilmington has done, that would net us about $40,000 a year for a rental just by using some of our town property to do this.
What's the size of that farm? Like, how much is it? An acre?
How many square feet is a megawatt?
I don't know the square feet. It's on top of one building, one warehouse building in Wilmington, on the roof.
Oh, so it's on a roof.
It's on a roof of one warehouse size building in Wilmington. I don't know how big the size is. But if we would establish such a facility and use it ourselves, then RMLD estimates that would probably save us, Reading, about $100,000 a year in operating costs. So of course we'd have to, you know, we'd have to buy it, we'd have to pay for it, and so forth. But there's an opportunity there, probably a better opportunity for us to actually use the results of this. And of course it would shave our own peak. All right, we would pay just a little bit less in those
hot summer days. About that, David, in terms of the advantages. I know this is RMLD and not the Climate Advisory Committee, but it'd be really keen to keep tabs on the total amount of actually produced, say mm-hmm. over a month or over a quarter or over a year. This is the capacity, but it's not the delivered benefit. This is what it could do, but not what it has done.
Yeah, it's designed.
It'd be interesting to compute the number of megawatt hours or kilowatt hours it's produced over the course of any time base, mm-hmm. Just to show the net value. And then, likewise, I know on your next page you have some other drawings about the economics. Mm-hmm. Curious to ask you a few questions about those.
Okay. So they're just starting now. So the meters just started to run on what they're actually producing. I think that's a good point. You know, what do we actually see? So this 250 kilowatt hours per month times 500 people, that's what we're sort of promised, but we'll see what it actually does. That was it on solar. I'm moving on to gas leaks. This is just an update on the gas leaks status. You know, we went through this whole process of doing resolutions, and there was a law passed last summer that said that we need the DPW or DPU has to look at gas leaks that have environmental consequence. That's this big yellow spike here. That's these grade 3 leaks. So what we saw in 2016 was that there were about as many new leaks in Reading as were fixed. So we're making precious little progress. I guess we actually lost one. You know, we got behind by one. Most of those new leaks are the grade 1 and grade 2 leaks, which means they're the hazardous leaks. The gas companies are not required to fix the grade 3 leaks, so they're going up a bit. This is pretty much the story. Across the state, I think the grade 3 leaks went from like 18,000 to 16,000, so they made some progress.
Do they at least fix all the grade 1 leaks?
They have to. So grade 1 leaks are immediately dangerous. Fix them until they're fixed. You know, all day, all night, whatever it takes, get out there and fix the leaks. You know, grade 2 is doesn't look good, could be a problem, fix it within a year. So that's where we are. There is a new bill, as I mentioned, to address the significant the leaks that have significant environmental impact. That means grade 3 leaks that are the high volume leaks. That's what that's about.
David, at one point, maybe it was last year, you actually had a metric that showed the amount of material lost.
Right.
The amount of stuff that it's evaporating or leaching into this into the atmosphere.
Uh-huh.
You have an update on that as part of this?
I don't think I brought this along. It's still in the 8 billion cubic feet per year range. There's depends on who.
8 billion cubic feet
of gas, natural gas per year
that leaks.
Uh-huh. So, yeah.
Statewide or countrywide?
Oh, statewide, not in Reading. Oh. It's not measured in Reading. Yeah. Yeah, you'd smell it.
No, I meant state versus federal.
Yeah.
And we're getting charged for that.
We are. We get charged for it. It's just it's rolled into the rate. You know, it's evaporation. You know, it's loss. It's part of the rate. And there are a couple of bills in the current legislature. One to prevent the gas companies from charging for that, which was a kind of a rehash of one that was introduced but not passed last year. There's also a law introduced this year to have DPU come up with some sort of a charging scheme to decide how much of the lost gas can even be put into that formula, or what penalties, in fact, the gas company should pay for that lost gas. So that has not, the situation is better a little bit. You know, it is not that much better than where we were a year ago. One of the areas that has gotten somewhat better is in trying coordinating, and I think we heard some of this earlier in the evening about trying to coordinate with the gas companies, you know, about ripping up infrastructure to make repairs. And MAPC and the HEAT held a workshop in September on coordinating between gas companies and municipalities. Gretchen attended this. Chris Cole from the DPW attended this last fall, and this is about what you can do between the municipalities and the the gas companies about coordinating. And so it's issues about what are the plans for road repairs? You know, what are the plans for main replacements? Who is it that's thinking they're going to come in and rip it up? And you know, it can first of all coordinate when we're doing that. And once it's done, you know, can we have a moratorium on coming back and ripping up the brand new street just to put in, you know, a brand new gas main? Or can we coordinate that kind of stuff? And it talks about that. Even a little more, aggressive has been, Boston has passed its own gas leaks ordinance, and there is a whole sort of procedure or recommendation for how any municipality can do this. And it relies on the city's authority over the roads. There are very few things where the city or the town has power that overrides the state, DPU and so forth in terms of regulation. But one of them where we do is with respect to the roads. The town controls the roads. So to rip up the road, you have to have approval from the town. So that's they passed an ordinance that says that Boston's gonna inform the gas company when the streets are open and ask them to come out and look at it. They want the gas company to tell them what's down there, you know, how old is this pipe, how big is it, how much gas is flowing through it, and to have these gas shut-off valves accessible. I thought we would have the answer, of course, you know, before today. I thought maybe this would be a moot topic, that we would either be off to do it or turned off altogether. However, we are offering an instructional motion at town meeting to explore options to draft a bag ban for Reading. This would be in consultation with the, you know, businesses, with citizens, and with the town staff and so forth on what's appropriate. There are 52 municipalities in Massachusetts that have such ordinances. I'd say the most common thing is just a blanket ban on the throwaway thin bags that are less than 2.5 mils thick, but it varies. Some go with up to a 4 mil thick bag. Some exempt small businesses like 3,000 square feet. Some charge 10 cents a bag. You can have the bags, but you're going to pay 10 cents a bag. You know, which, if you know, come out of the grocery store, you're probably talking $1, right? Mm-hmm. And so there are variations to look at as what's acceptable in this town, and also various things that other towns have put into their laws.
Yeah. Dave, given what you just said, could I make a suggestion in your wording in that instructional motion?
Mm,
in
okay.
place of the word ban, regulate the use of, that might include a ban, but it might include other things leading up to a ban. I can buy a bag in Cambridge when I go to Micro Center.
Mm-hmm.
They don't ban me from having that bag there. I think we need to be flexible. You did get 34 signatures, but there are over 19,000 adults in this community probably that know nothing about this right
mm-hmm.
now. And you're going to need a big public outreach effort.
Right.
So I would hope you could work in that spirit if you're going to go to town meeting.
Oh, yeah, for sure. So
would you be willing to make that change?
The change to replace
Instead
the ban with a...
Regulate the use of.
Regulate the use of, yeah, that's fine. Mm-hmm.
Would you...
Will
you be willing to propose?
Sure.
Present
sure.
it as such?
Yeah.
Any other questions, comments?
I have one.
Mm-hmm.
Who's the author of the instructional motion?
Me.
I figured.
And so you have yourself instructing the Climate Advisory Committee where you're the chair.
Right.
Wouldn't you want to instruct a different entity? It seems circular to do that.
So we could, part of the reason for doing this. Yeah, sure, it's circular. I mean, part of the reason for doing this is to get a sense of the level of interest in the town. In other words,
mm-hmm.
we didn't need an instructional motion to go off and prepare a bag ban and come to the town meeting and say,
sure.
"Here's a bag ban." You know?
Could have just come to us.
Yeah, we could have done.
Well, the bylaw committee.
Yeah, we could have done that.
Well,
but,
to us.
But I thought it was more appropriate to do that this way, just to test the waters and also solicit some interest, maybe some more participation and so forth. So that's why we did it this way. I don't know who else would be doing it.
Dan?
What would be your plan to involve the Board of Selectmen in this process?
Probably advisory. I think we need some help to get it organized. You know,
mm-hmm.
what kind of people need to participate, and also what level of town support would be appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
I think we would like some business support and business participation. I mean, any citizen who wants to is fine, you know. That, but we want to make sure that some of our businesses are you know, involved. Particularly, I mean, we got the big businesses, you know, the grocery store type. But I mean, the little businesses too, you know, what their feeling is about it. And then what it would mean, you know, as far as if you get into enforcement issues, you know, then there's who's gonna, how would that work, you know, that what would the town have to do to enforce something like that?
One of the other questions I would raise is the first sentence says explore options, and then it says to draft a bylaw to ban. Dan's
mm-hmm.
already suggested to speak more about regulation, but another option you might consider is the use of biodegradable material. So there's starch-based plastics now
mm-hmm.
that degrade in sunlight in
yep.
3 to 4 months. Peanuts now are all starch-based for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
Is that an alternative?
Sure, sure. I mean, so other town, you know, other towns, they look at reusable, recyclable, and biodegradable alternatives, you know, as bag material, you know. Or even thicker plastic bags that are, I mean, that fall into the reusable category, you know. The problem, of course, with these, what we're talking about here, the real thin ones, is, you know, just a little gust of wind will pick them up and carry them off somewhere. They jam up the equipment on the recycling and, equipment, you know. It's not like we're not going to have bags, but
I just want to make sure I understand what you're saying. So you're open to the prospect of, say, thin film biodegradables, which would disappear.
Mm-hmm.
If I understand, is that correct?
Yeah, sure.
You're open to the prospect of 3 mil, 4 mil, or thicker.
So I mean, if the ban was 2.5, then 3 mils would be okay, right?
Okay.
Some towns have up to 4 mils, not okay. But, you know, I mean, that's the kind of thing that we'd have to look at.
So your primary concern is it gets airborne and it takes off.
Well, there's a lot of things, right? I mean, one of them is just trash, and it just collects, and it just gets airborne and goes. And one of the problems is it gets into the machinery on in the recycling and gucks it up. One of the problems is it's the plastic bags are eaten by animals and fish and everything.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, it's a danger to wildlife, and it collects toxins. And I mean, you know, it's sort of like no one thing makes it awful. It's a whole lot of different things that make it a target.
How does the thick bag solve those last three or four problems?
They're recyclable. I mean, they're reusable.
Oh, the reusability aspect.
Reusable, yeah.
I see. Question?
Yeah, I just think if I encourage you, whatever process or road this goes down, to really involve the business community.
Yes.
And especially I would approach Stop and Shop and Market Basket, because mm-hmm. they are the two largest distributors of these bags probably in town, and that obviously would any kind of ban or regulation would impact them. So I would encourage you to reach out. I know they're big organizations, they may not desire to participate, but at least to make that effort, because that's going to be the biggest impact is going to be on them.
I agree, and we've already talked to Market Basket about this, and of course they're also familiar with this because they're dealing with these bags in the 52 communities that have already done this. So yeah,
they may have a lot to offer in terms of,
I think,
insight.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would you characterize that conversation as a favorable outcome?
I think it was mixed. They don't really want to do it, but they're finding that already the requests for those bags is decreasing. People are bringing their own bags or boxes or whatever, so there's less demand. And they understand what's involved because they have had to do it elsewhere, but they sort of take this. Several businesses have taken the attitude that it's a choice, it's a customer choice, you know, and that if they don't have plastic bags, that I will go to the Market Basket in Wakefield because they have them or something. I find that a little bit of a reach, but you know it wasn't like antagonistic. It was just more of a, well, there's hair on this problem.
They have to handle the situation. Somebody walks in, doesn't have a bag, and has five items.
Well, they'd have to have some other form of bag, paper bags or.
What if they don't have that with them? What do they do?
No. I mean, the business would have to have paper bags or thicker bags or something or.
Don't those use more energy to create paper bags?
No, these plastic bags,
the kind that
I know, but
the handles.
Yeah, but I don't think they take more energy. These are made out of oil, right? I mean, these are.
I understand.
Yeah. So they're refined material.
Would you be willing to, based on the conversation we just completed, would you be willing to augment your instructional motion to comprehend the use of the biodegradables and the whatever thickness bag you described earlier as acceptable alternatives? Excuse me.
Well, what I want to do is this exploration, you know, is just put it all on the table. If you're saying jump to the answer.
I'm saying in the spirit of exploration, one of the things you might do is actually seed the conversation with examples of what your ideas, mm-hmm. idea generation.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm not trying to prescribe an outcome, only that if you're interested in ideas, one way to get more is to give them a couple as seed material.
Mm-hmm.
It might take off.
So like I was saying, so biodegradable, reusable, recyclable, all good options.
Good. Any other questions from the board?
Yeah, a question. So for the biodegradable ones, is much of the trash in Massachusetts burned now?
I don't know.
I think less, a lot less, because of the airborne pollutant restrictions.
Where does it happen?
What happens to our trash?
What happens to our trash? And, yeah, Gina.
So it goes to Covanta, right, which does have a lot of, so it burned waste to energy.
Right.
That was actually an interesting problem when we did the software, Clean Air Cool Planet software to figure out our emissions. They didn't even have that as an option in the software. It's so rare. So if you recall the Marathon bombing, they found the laptops in a landfill. So in many areas in Massachusetts, the trash still goes to landfills. There's just a few incinerators our community happens to. These pictures on the bottom, by the way, are in our community. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of bags, roadside, streams. So we have a problem here, but even though it does go to an incinerator.
So let me just make sure I understand. The trash from Reading goes to ash landfills, incinerators and ash landfills primarily?
The incinerator does have ash waste.
Right, yes. Yeah, I've been to them. And they have air scrubbers and stuff like that for their particulates. So a lot, and unfortunately, the starch-based bags would be thrown away and burned, I assume, instead of being biodegraded. Is that right?
Well, if they throw them in the trash, yeah, that's where it's going.
They don't end up over here in the yard. They go away.
Well, that's something I think we need to study, because some of the, I mean, we've done a little bit of research on it, and it's not clear that when they say they're biodegradable, that they are. You have to be very careful how you define it. So that would be something that the committee, whoever did, would have to look at carefully.
Okay. That's it. Questions? John?
All set.
Bob?
Where this discussion has gone a little wider, I just want to, just as a realistic mention, that if you want a bylaw for November town meeting, we have a saying that if the bylaw is not knee-high by the 4th of July, it's not going to happen in November. So the selectmen will close the warrant in September.
Mm-hmm.
Town council needs to review things in the summer. So just as a caution, it sounded like you just put a lot on someone's plate with a lot of different options. So just be realistic that November may or may not be realistic. That's all. The more input you want from the community, the more options there are to be studied.
Yeah.
Take whatever pace you need, but just.
And what do you recommend? That we
I don't have a recommendation other than don't be in a rush, but be aware that November town meeting sounds like a really long time away.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually not, in order to get the process where it needs to be.
Your byproduct will be better if you take the time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so there are, like I said, there's 52 examples to draw from. The issue is local input, you know, business input and individual input.
Yeah. With that in mind, is there any public input on the conversation today? I'm sorry, yes.
Hi, Dimitri Tsekris. I'm on Oak Street, and I would love to be of any help I can be in this effort. I think it's great.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Yes.
Gina McCormick from North Hill Road, and I just wanted to say I moved up here from D.C. in Montgomery County, Maryland, which, as you probably know, instituted this ban several years ago, and people pay for things there. And I was just reading a story about how good or bad that has worked out for them, and they've raised a lot of money doing it, actually, haven't decreased a ton of bag usage. So I just wondered if any of those 52 Massachusetts communities, if they also have studies about how much money they've raised, if we're thinking about revenue generation.
I'm sure they do. I don't know. I mean, that's a good question, yeah.
Okay.
And who gets the revenue in this state? Do you know?
I guess we'll just keep it.
What do you mean we?
Best answer.
Dave and I will.
Yeah. Bob and I will figure out what to do with that.
Any further questions for Mr. Zeke?
Yeah, thank you, Dave.
Thank you, Dave.
Since they are going to be time is going to be coming up soon. Do we want to entertain a motion about keeping them going now, or are we going to have them come back? What time? I don't know.
We need to construction emotional be in town meeting?
No, he's talking about the.
No, I'm talking about.
Sunset.
The sunset.
That'll come up naturally next month, right?
Yeah, I think we need to have a discussion.
Yeah, they're already, it's already scheduled on an agenda in the month of June, so.
It will be timely.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks, thank you, everybody.
We're about 36 minutes behind. We have the Reading Ice Arena liaison report.
I want to thank the audience for coming in for the Ice Arena report. It's very exciting.
One of the more exciting.
Yes.
Good news, do I?
I'm actually bringing money, so that is a positive there. Thank you. Carl McFadden, 33 Wakefield Street, been your liaison on the Ice Arena for, I don't know, probably a decade, thereabouts. Some background, and I know Andrew is new to the board, congratulations. The Ice Arena is a public-private partnership, essentially, where Nelson Burbank donated the funds to create it, and this is our 23rd year of being in business, shall we say, and it has, the Ice Arena has made a contribution to the town of direct cash of $2.3 million over that time. The nice thing about tonight's meeting was I called down to the ice to find out what the check was for this year. There was a little panic stricken because it was not cashed as of yet. So they ended up reissuing the check, and the town received $58,000. That, from a budgetary standpoint, correct me if I'm wrong, Bob, they never count on it. It's kind of like a rainy day fund. The exciting part is with 2 months left to go, the Ice Arena feels very comfortable. The contribution for fiscal 2018 will be almost $100,000 unexpected revenue to the facility. Ed Peduto has been the general manager since day one, but Ed has a 97-year-old man that visits the facility daily, sometimes twice a day, to make sure everything is running very smoothly. One of the additional things is the Ice Arena has $311,000, which is the threshold we need to maintain in our rainy day fund, so if anything ever happens. Mr. Burbank always wanted to make sure it was never going to be a white elephant to the town, which some people that can remember a couple years ago, Stoneham had their town has a disaster there. In Wilmington, yes, Wilmington, I forgot about that. Wilmington was very bad. One of the other things in reference to, and I see one of the school committee members here, that's going on now, is because Reading's facility is owned by the town, as opposed to a private entity. There's a story two or three days ago up in Essex Vocational School is actually owned privately. And the prep schools are trying to buy their way in terms of they're offering more money per hour. And the high school teams are having a very difficult time getting facilities as well as the youth programs because they're going out to the highest bidder because they're private entities. The nice thing about Reading never has to worry about that. We did have a certain prep school in the town of Reading, remain nameless, Austin Prep. With all due respect, they were looking to get some of their time because the overall philosophy is Reading kids come first in terms of the black and red. Yeah, that's the wishes of it was, as well as the youth program, as well as the boys and girls varsity and JV teams. So we're very happy to be able to give them any excess time. And, you know, that 6 a.m. on Sunday morning is usually an available time that they're able to get. But, you know, we try working with them. You know, North Reading tried coming down, and that didn't work out so well because they're green and yellow and Reading's black and red. So that's just kind of works. But, no, we try working with everyone if there's excess. The nice thing is that all the youth programs are done, needs are met. A lot of adult leagues is actually it's growing as a women's. Hockey league that's actually doing gangbusters, which is exciting. So we meet all the needs, well funded, plenty of money coming in, which is excellent. And I was allotted 15 minutes, and I can answer questions for 8 more if you want, or we can move forward.
You give the Reading students a good discount.
Yes, the Reading, I'm sorry, in the indirect, typically we save the school system about $15,000 because you give them a discounted rate. So that's, if you added up that number, it would be almost another $150,000 of indirect savings to the town. So it's worked, it's been a great public-private partnership.
Any questions from the board, Andrew? I have a couple of my own.
Sure.
Operating hours, say, what limits your operating hours, is your practicality, there's no demand?
Typically, you know, the adults like to come in around, they have that 10 o'clock, you know, put the kids to bed, and then get their frustrations out for the kids not going to bed on time, and they go there and play hockey. But typically, we're done, excuse me, done by 11, open at 6 in the morning. But during the summertime, it will, you know, right now, people are outside, as opposed to wanting to be in there skating, so.
And what contributes to the, I'll call it volatility, but the difference year to year in the portion return to Reading, what contributes to $100,000 a year versus a $50,000 a year?
For instance, 2 years ago, we went out and bought a Zamboni, it had to be replaced. They're extremely, extremely proactive on repairs. You know, your chiller machine may have some issues, there's some air quality issues, you always have to maintain the filters, that type of stuff. You know, probably 10 years ago, we had a Title IX issue presented by the schools for a locker room. That was like $300,000.
Was there one this year that
no.
You can point to?
No, there's no issue, but I'm just saying historically, because it can be up and down. One of the most important things is the fact that they're Epiduto, who's, you know, he's kind of like a god of the ice arena operation world, is so proactive on getting the newest technology and dealing with the boards and making sure everything is up to speed, because the last thing you want to do is have, you know, something really break, and now all of a sudden you're talking the $200,000 when it could have been prevented.
Well, you utilize the same philosophy as the town does on just making sure we invest in capital, and so that you don't wind up with a big bill later on.
Yep. No, I mean, every year out of our operating account, we're spending a little less than $100,000 on capital type of items. You know, something, believe it or not, something as simplistic as repairing the parking lot that the baseball programs use in town. You know, when you're plowing in the winter, you sometimes dig a few potholes there. So that's always being proactive, being there.
I just think this shows the foresight of Nelson Burbank to have, first of all, the generosity, and second of all, the vision to create a self-sustaining entity that generates cash and provides a place to go for a lot of Reading youth and folks that are beyond youth, right?
And he's sitting center ice on every high school game and will voice his opinion if the team's playing as well as he wants it to. And one of the things is that if anyone ever, Andrew, you're obviously new to the board, from the original discussion probably 26 years ago, Nelson still has his notes if you want to review it and have any discussion with him. So he makes sure that is pointed out. He knows where it is. So.
Don't new selectmen get a ride on the Zamboni, isn't that it?
That is fun. That's actually fun. Or, you know, sometimes you got to be careful. You don't get in front of it, you don't get run over by the Zamboni, right?
That's true. Yeah. Any public comment?
No.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
One quick thing.
Yes.
Thank you, Paula, for everything over the years, and enjoy your retirement.
You're welcome.
Okay. Next, we have the RMLD Citizen Advisory Board member update.
Neil Cohen.
Hi, Neil.
Hello.
Congratulations. 6 minutes. Hi, Neil. Good evening.
Hey, everybody. I'm Neil Cohen, 73 Hillcrest Road. I don't have much of a report. I am here to answer any questions to the best that I can. I've been on the Citizens Advisory Board for a total of 2 months, maybe 3 months, and I've been to 3 or 4 meetings. So I'm learning terms, learning vernacular, trying to understand what's going on.
The Citizens Advisory Board is a bit of a liaison between us and RMLD.
Correct.
In the past, it's been helpful to give us heads up on two particular issues that were, I'd say, anomalies, clear anomalies. One was early on the proposal to consume and destroy renewable energy credits, and that came through in a variety of ways, but it also came through the the CAB, and then an issue with retirement of old capital equipment. So it's always good to have another set of eyes on you. Some of these are innocent; they're not. There's no malicious behavior at all. It's just some of these things happen infrequently, but it's good to have a second set of eyes. What have you learned in your first 2 months?
I've learned there's a lot I don't know.
Sorry?
I've learned there's a lot I don't know, honestly. I have not seen anything that has caused me any concern yet. As I said, I've been to 3 Citizen Advisory Board meetings. I've been to 1 commissioner's meeting. and I'm just learning my way. So in the meetings I've sat with and through, I've just trying to get up to speed and understand what's going on, or what the responsibilities are, how the Citizens Advisory Board reports to the commissioners of the RMLD as well. And there's nothing that has concerned me yet. And when I talked with the two selectmen that appointed me, that was one of the tasks that I was given to be their eyes. And so that's something that I have taken to heart.
Why'd you do it? What was in it for you?
There was nothing in it for me, actually. I was asked by...
You didn't mean that literally.
No, I know, I know. I was asked by one of the RMLD commissioners if I was interested in helping out. We lost the member for Reading. I've been a serial volunteer. So I once, when my first position, I was serving on the FinCom with Bob. So that tells you how long ago that was. And I've had a variety of roles over time. One of the things that I've held true is that they don't want to be in the same position on the same board for an extended period of time, because I think it gets stale as well. So I'd like to, every once in a while, change it up and find something else.
Well, thank you for your volunteerism. You have there's a large cadre of volunteers like yourself, and Reading's blessed to have all of them. So thank you for your time. Bob?
I do want to mention, I haven't had a chance to chat with you yet, that there was mention of an instructional motion coming to town meeting, which will now be Thursday night. I'll follow up with you. It involved studying the cash flow to the town from RMLD and improving it. So I'll keep you abreast of that.
Okay. Sit down and chat. Thank you.
Any other questions from the board? Public input? Thank you very much, Neil.
Thanks, Neil.
All right.
Good to see you.
Thank you all.
Next on the agenda is the Housing Authority report. Now 19 minutes behind.
Catching up.
It's up to you.
Hello.
Good evening.
Kevin Mulvey, one of the board members, and I live at 67 Whittier Road. RHA continues to run and operate state and federal housing programs. Currently we have about 223 total programs, 125 federal, Section 8. And 98 state units under Section 8. Funding and lack of funding is still causing some restrictions for us to utilize additional vouchers that may be offered to us. State programs, under the state, RHAs continue to retain revenue account or retain revenue agency, meaning we don't receive any state fundings from DHCD to operate day-to-day programs. You folks, and Bob in particular, feel the same type of financial strain on utility costs, insurance costs, but benefits costs, causing us to have a little tighter controls on the state programs. Some of the elderly, non-elderly programs have 1 to 3, sometimes 1 to 5 year waiting periods, a little bit shorter for a local and a veteran's preference. Some of the family programs are a little bit longer wait. We only have 10 family units currently in Reading right now, so there's an extensive waiting period for that, and there's very little turnover. From an RHA administrative perspective, Lynn White, who's on a well-earned vacation right now, was able to confirm that for FY18 and 19, RHA has received almost $142,000 for future projects that were part of our five-year capital plan. Those projects have been submitted to DHCD and have already been approved. For our current fiscal year, we've actually seen almost $77,000 expended in part of the current capital plan. Things like in our elderly Tannerville facility, we've had new flooring, new lighting, new painting. Mm-hmm. Every year Lynn submits a capital plan that we as board members vote on and have approved. So the last item, just I found somewhat interesting. In the last fiscal year, RHA has gone under 4 separate audits without any additional finding of issue or problem. John Ross CPA has done an annual financial audit. DHCD has issued a relatively newly mandated procedural audit. HUD has issued an audit for this year for RHA for the Section 8 program, And I believe that for the first time in Lynn's 17 year of leadership at RHA, that's the first time she's ever had to go through that audit. And then there's a brand new audit issued by DHCD as well regarding some performance management procedures. Lynn has volunteered RHA to be part of a pilot on those audits there. And the full audit is not expected until later on this year. The last point I think is somewhat interesting. I think we've all heard about some pretty difficult circumstances around other public housing agencies around the Commonwealth. I think we're pretty fortunate to have someone like Lynn as executive director. I think she runs a great operation. And, you know, my 8 years on the board, I've never known one issue to pop up that Lynn hasn't been able to handle relatively quickly and professionally. So I think we're pretty fortunate to have someone like Lynn as our executive director. Happy to answer any questions.
Yeah. What are the total number of units?
223.
And Bob, you'll have to help me, but wasn't there an instance or two of some of those falling outside of our control?
Yeah, over the last 5 or 10 years, there's been a handful of units that came off the affordable list.
Yep.
Last 2 years, actually.
Isn't that recently?
We lost several.
Okay. Yeah, and I know Kevin Sexton. Well, Kevin Sexton was working with them with town council. Certainly, I never heard of any wrongdoing, but I did hear a statement from Lynn saying that her job was not to worry about the town's affordable unit legal count, I guess is the fairest way to say it. So that that was our job, not hers. Hers was to manage the 223 units that she had under her.
And the way that those
housing authority,
the way
it's quite a partnership.
Well, yeah, it's not really the ideal situation. Honestly, it should be in all of our interest to provide affordable housing and to make sure the state understands what we have, and that we understand our situation, so that if there are units coming off the list, we know that. If there's something simple we can do, whether it's something you should do or we should do, we're happy to help. It's in all of our interest to maintain affordable housing, parentheses, prohibit 40B projects.
Yeah. And the mechanism, I'm sorry, somebody didn't hear that?
Yeah, I was just gonna say is that, you know, we'll never get the hours back in our life that it's taken us to create these affordable units. So it's really troubling to me that that a board doesn't sort of share that zeal. And so what I'd like to see, because I know these are done by deed restriction, can we just do an audit of what we have? You know, maybe we get a law student from somewhere, someone who interns with Ray, to go and look at the deeds on all of the units that we own to see if any of them have, if they've expired, and if so, if there's a way for us to go back and retroactively fix it so that they don't come off. The hours that it takes to create an affordable unit and then to lose it because we're not rowing in the same direction is frankly, it's more than troubling. So I don't know if we can work together as the board or working with Ray's office, but I would like to see us, at least, do an internal audit of 223 units and look at those deeds and just see, kind of where we are and take proactive action to make sure that we keep them in perpetuity.
John?
I would echo that. I mean, based on, and that's not the first time I've heard that comment, Bob.
Yeah.
We actually heard that over the course of the last couple of years. And if in fact that's the posture that's being taken by the director, then if that's our job, good. We'll step in and let it be our job. It strikes me that, a more cohesive partnership would be a lot better way to go about it, but if the job's going to be left to us, we will do it, because Barry is absolutely right. Putting one of these things online is painful, and so the idea of losing them, essentially because the paperwork isn't being managed correctly, is not okay.
And the number and sequence that are done would suggest that it's not a random problem; that there's maybe a systemic issue. You lose one, I get it. I don't know whether deed restrictions time out or whether they're in perpetuity. But to the extent that there's a pattern or fact pattern, it does suggest that it bears more investigation, to echo John's comment. We spend a bunch of time trying to wrestle with affordable housing. We're blessed the next 12 months to have a stay of further 40Bs, at least the ones that aren't already known to us. And I can't fathom for a moment why an organization that works within the town would permit, other than by accident or innocent oversight, allow something to escape. And I, can you say a few words about how these happen, or are they known to you, the circumstances we're talking about?
The circumstances are not known to me, but to address Barry, John, and your point, John, what I'd like to do is bring this back up to Lynn when she returns.
Okay.
And it's clear that some, there are issues between, you know, the two bodies, and I think they need to be worked out. With the comments and concerns you've echoed are not lost on me, but I'd like to have the rest of my
sure.
board members, colleagues, sure. and Lynn together. We can have those discussions to address your concerns. I mean, your concerns are duly noted, and I'm not in a position to necessarily disagree with you. I just...
It seems like our mission statements are aligned, so if the execution and the mission are different than... Sorry, the execution is different than the mission statement, we need to figure out why. Any other comments from the board? Up? Public? Any comments from the public? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Update from the Board of Selectmen Working Group. What I'd like to do over the next 30 minutes is bring the other three members of the board, along with Barry's help, up to speed on what work that we did working together with representatives of the human rights resolution in your packet tonight is some of the background material, which I won't dwell on. But what I want to do is take some time and bring the board up to speed. When there are no further questions from the board, we'll take questions from the audience, if any. And we've got another item, several items after this, so I will cut this off at 30 minutes. It's 9 o'clock now. So, Barry, jump in here if
sure,
you'd
no,
like.
No,
but Barry and I met with representatives from the signatories on March 6th and March 9th, a total of about 4 hours. I played Paula that night, and so the notes show accordingly what I can do. So next time we definitely need Paula. Yeah, but the audio for the meetings is also, as well as the minutes, are also on the town website, which I felt was important because no set of minutes really capture a discussion or dialogue or the sidebars like an audio does. So I looked at the count a few days after, and I did see that it was up into the dozens. Not overwhelming subscription, but better than nothing. I presume you guys have read the minutes, and I'd entertain any questions, and Barry and I'd be happy to answer them. Andrew?
I listened to their, I think it's more like 4.5 hours of audio.
With no video, it's like a black screen.
Sunny,
you're just staring at that.
Sunny California. I pretended I was listening
to music.
That
was like your
music.
First Board of Selectmen meeting.
It was exciting, let me tell you. So I'm up to speed.
Right.
Thanks.
Yeah?
I'm up to speed, too.
Okay.
I've reviewed the audio tapes.
Okay. Well, that was quick. any comment from the public? Yes.
Gina McCormick. I was one of the subcommittee members.
Thank you for doing that.
Thank you, along with Caitlin and Mitra. And we wanted to bring up a couple of points. As you saw in the packet, there was a town council's opinion that came out on the revised resolution. And as Bob knows, we had gone back and forth about asking for that opinion several times. And we discovered it when we came upon the packet for this meeting. So we just wanted to bring that up and say that I don't know where the breakdown in communication is for that. I think that we wanted to see it. It wasn't shown to us. It came in a week and a half ago or something. In preparation for this meeting, we would have hoped that we could review it. And so we certainly would ask, just in sort of future workings with the board and volunteers, that the communication be expanded in that respect. But we did see it yesterday, and we, as the folks who sat in the meeting will know, we do disagree with town council's assessment, specifically as it relates to his opinion that a town body cannot condemn hate speech in an opinion document, and the resolution we, as he mentions in his opinion letter, the resolution is an opinion document. It is not policy, it's not regulation. So yesterday, we read that. We have been waiting for that to sort of see what else we could do regarding the resolution. And so we sort of scrambled, and we did get an opinion from the ACLU of Massachusetts that we wanted to share with the board. It's from Sarah Wunsch, the deputy legal director of the ACLU.
Do you have copies of those?
We do, yeah.
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Do you want them, maybe after I can pass them up for the record? Okay. So this is, again, Sarah Wunsch, the deputy legal director of the ACLU Foundation of Massachusetts, and she wrote to us. I reviewed the human rights resolution your community group submitted to the town board of selectmen. I understand that the board felt that the resolution would violate the First Amendment and did not proceed to vote on it. I do not believe that the First Amendment prevents local officials from speaking out and condemning what they view as hateful and divisive speech. It would be a different situation if government officials took action against someone or a group based on the views they express. But certainly local governments routinely condemn attitudes and ideas they believe are harmful to a community. They have a voice and can generally express views that represent that community. There may be sometimes some limits, example, if they endorse a religious group. In general, we often call upon government officials to speak out critically when hateful speech is made, as a better way to respond than trying to shut down that speech, a step that would violate the First Amendment. Indeed, the ACLU itself condemns bigoted and prejudiced statements while defending the rights of the speakers. I should make clear that the ACLU makes a distinction between hate speech and hate crimes. Hate speech is protected by the First Amendment, although it can be criticized and condemned, while acts motivated by bias can be prosecuted as hate crimes. I hope this is helpful to you, and I will be happy to talk to town council about this issue. So I just wanted to make sure everyone understood we weren't coming from left field during the subcommittee meetings, and we do strongly disagree with town council's opinion. We thought it was important, since we did work on a revised resolution during the course of that, based on our discussions, we thought it was important that the folks in town hear that resolution. Not everyone reads the packets as we do so diligently. So I do, with your indulgence, do want to read the work that we came up with from that subcommittee, if that's okay.
This is the second version.
Yes.
Yeah, it's on the web for those watching from home. It's been on the website since, I think, the 10th of March, under the March 9th meeting. Go ahead.
Thank you. So this is the revised resolution that we put together during the subcommittee based on the concerns of the subcommittee, based on community concerns. Is Bill still here?
Left.
No, he left.
Oh,
I had a particular shout out to Bill
right.
In this, but we did work, I think, in good faith and very diligently to ameliorate a lot of the concerns that we were hearing from the community, from the selectmen, and even from letters to the editor. As you may know, Bill Brown did write, and he had a concern about a resolution not speaking for individual residents. That was his main concern, and we did remove those during the course of the subcommittee, references to that. There are many community members who talked about preferring a less formal and more inviting document, folks who preferred a prose document over sort of the proclamation idea. So we did end up changing the format of the document. We think the tone of the document, I think it turned out to be a stronger document at the end of the subcommittee. We added in some First Amendment protection language, removed the word reject just to make it much more clear for our objective, which was taking an opinion on speech rather than prohibiting it. We also heard the selectmen's concerns that they not be perceived as directing other officials to take action. That was part of our first meeting that we had, and those references were removed. So that's a little bit of a background of how we came to this second document, which reads, "We believe that the strength of our town and nation is derived from the history of diversity that has enriched our communities, with a variety of cultures, faith traditions, and viewpoints. Reading is a community that believes in and defends this nation's bedrock principles of equal opportunity, equal protection of the law, and religious freedom. As a community, We welcome and embrace all who live here, work here, study here, worship here, and visit here, regardless of gender, race, color, religion, national origin, sexual orientation, gender identity, or disability. We vigorously uphold human rights and ensure the well-being and safety of all in our community. We also recognize that our own histories are shaped by the immigrant experience, and we welcome new neighbors here, wherever they may come from. While we cannot and will not alter or abridge the rights, protections, and privileges secured by state and federal law, including the constitutional protections of free speech and assembly, we will stand up to those who will seek to undermine the beliefs and human rights we hold dear. We will condemn those words and acts of hate and intolerance that undermine our neighborhoods, communities of faith, and schools. We will work with public safety and education officials to continue to build trust with everyone in our community, and we reaffirm our commitment to ensure the safety and well-being of every person within the Reading community. We believe in the basic tenets of our political process. We argue, we campaign, we debate passionately. But on the fundamental human rights protections discussed herein, we are entirely and enthusiastically united. We wanted to put to you, based on the work that we did in the subcommittee and the information that we got today from the ACLU based on a review of the document and an understanding of town council's opinion, wanted to see if the board did want to, as the facts you have now, did want to take a vote on the revised resolution.
Yeah, to be clear, tonight is pure, this is the first time the three other members have talked to the board. If the board observes open meeting law, well, we all met, the board hasn't had a chance, and frankly, the board hasn't asked any questions. This is the format to do it. We won't take any action tonight other than address questions and a few public comments. Our next meeting will have a segment to actually discuss what the board wants to do from this point forward. We won't do that element tonight. This is purely to get baselined on history and the past. And now that we're all, your comments are well received, I wouldn't expect the board is ready, because it hasn't deliberated on what it wants to do as a group. So. Andrew.
So, when I saw the town council's weigh-in on this, he concluded by saying the board should carefully consider the role that it would be assuming in expressing a preference for or against protected speech. And so I did, I tried to do a fair amount of homework on this. I listened to the proceedings, and I just wanted to share a few thoughts of what I learned. One thing that I read various letters to the editor, posts online, and unfortunately, I know that it's been a little controversial, and there's some difference of opinion in town, which is healthy for town. But some of the, I think there's some at least what I see is some misperceptions about what the resolution was not. For example,
Yeah. I don't want to get into the debate of what it is. Tonight I only want mm-hmm. the baseline that you understand the history that's taken us to this point.
Right.
In our next meeting, mm-hmm. we will have a segment dedicated to as a workshop, which is what we've described. Mm-hmm. But it occurred to me we couldn't very well have a workshop because the group hadn't gotten baseline. So not understanding what you might come
that's
in
fine.
And what the public might have to say,
mm-hmm.
I don't want to do any work beyond this point until our next meeting, which we'll have a dedicated purpose for us to deliberate and discuss where we go next. And I have some ideas on that as well, but I won't share them tonight until we have a chance in that second meeting to chat about it. Dan?
Question. Mr. Chairman, did the group discuss the actual origins of this petition? Was it authored by one of the petitioners? Was it?
I think in the first minutes, I think that came up in the first minutes.
I think actually when they came to present it the first time, it just sort of talked about how it was just a group of people just sort of got together sort of ad hocly. Is that a word? In an ad hoc manner. And I think you guys didn't even know each other.
Exactly.
You know, and you just sort of maybe went to a human relations advisory committee meeting and talked about it, but then just sort of, you know, gathered on your own and talked to other people. So I think it was, and correct me if I'm wrong, but from in the meeting that it was discussed that they just sort of kind of bubbled out from just the what's going on, so.
I seem to remember an email chain in one of our packets that suggested that this petition originated in its original form, not the form we're seeing it, as a downloaded petition from the city of San Francisco, which addressed.
I just addressed that. So, sure. So we came to the Human Relations Advisory Committee meeting. Demetra came. I had never met Demetra before. She said, some communities are doing things. Here's a couple of examples of things that people have been doing. I read it and had no intention of joining with Demetra if she wanted to write that, frankly. And I love you, but that wasn't my intention.
Yeah,
I don't think that was any of our intentions.
Because we're not San Francisco.
Right. So we met afterwards. We got clear about what our expectations were about the document that we were going to write. We got input from folks in town. We got input from clergy. I personally got input from people of color, from folks from minority religious groups, people from the LGBT community. So I think that it was very organic in its sort of how we started and how that got in there. It was an email from someone that wasn't a part of our drafting group. So just so we're all clear, it was sort of a left turn that never was a turn at all.
Thank you. Yeah. So, you know, we didn't imagine that in the public record. It was there. Let's make no mistake about that. Furthermore, and clearly what you have here is very different from that. I do acknowledge that. But, you know, you can understand some concerns because if you compared in that email chain the lift from San Francisco to the first resolution that was presented to us, there was an alarmingly strong comparison between those two. And I think it certainly gave me pause when that happened.
I think
happened.
There's a little time. I'm sorry, I actually never read the entire San Francisco resolution, so I could do a side-by-side, but.
Just respond to the chair.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I think the factual statement is whether it was in the email chain, not whether it was read by an individual at all.
Okay.
Was there.
But I think there's an implication being discussed that this was sort of, you know, a conspiracy of outsiders coming in and reading and, you know, foisting, you know, kind of a left-wing bent.
I haven't heard that yet.
I mean, I think that's the implication of what's been kind of here. You know, I think that.
I haven't heard that yet. Any other comments from the group?
Hi, I just want to clarify about it. The San Francisco resolution was in an email chain, but it was not in an email chain prior to our coming to present our resolution, unless it was an email chain that was a private one, I don't know. So I just want to make sure there's a lot of timeline stuff that are of concern, things, you know, legal counsel was available and wasn't made available to us, even though we asked for it repeatedly. I mean, this happened a lot throughout this process, so we just want to make sure that misunderstandings aren't turned into misinformation, which happened a little through.
So, you know, town council wouldn't have been made available to a citizen group that exists
for servicing the town and its deliberations. It serves here to review what we're going to deliberate, but it doesn't exist as a service to the town. It sent citizens in the execution of their private duties.
Yes. However, it was my understanding that when then Chairman Halsey directed us to the subcommittee to sit around at a round table, that we would have town council weigh in on the document.
And I responded to that very point and explained that that wasn't what I understood. I actually answered that directly. And I still don't believe that's what he meant because I understand the role of town council. It just wouldn't have been that way. But that's almost 6 weeks ago, and while I appreciate the earlier confusion, I'm not sure it's material now. We have the town council's review. It's in front of us. We have another 2 weeks minimum before we have the discussion about the deliberation and what the board wants to do. Tonight is just getting baselined on how we've caught up. Any other comments? Linda?
Linda Snowdoxer.
I'm sorry, just, we have 10 more minutes for this, so just try to keep your comments as brief as you can. Most of this stuff has been talked about previously.
I'll be very quick. That email chain was from me because the Human Relations Advisory Committee had communicated with the Selectmen to clarify that our vote was to recommend, we're an advisory committee, and we had recommended that the Selectmen consider seriously and approve the human rights resolution. In my email, I had explained how far that group had come and that they had brought in that resolution as one example of one that has been made. And my point in that email was how far they had come, taking it away from the political document that San Francisco had to make sure that it was an enduring document that could speak for the town. It was not their original. In fact, as was just restated, the people, that committee, the drafters, didn't even exist at that point. We had a number of new people at our committee who were directed to us. And then in the discussion, they joined together, and then they drafted what you have seen and have worked with you.
Okay.
So the San Francisco version is not what you have in front of you, and it's not, it was just one example to start the discussion.
Okay, thank
so
you.
So I want to make sure that my comments are not misunderstood.
Other comments? Yes, ma'am.
Chris Holmes, I'm from Redgate Lane. I do not understand the need for this document. I have lived here for over 40 years, and I have never had, I felt my neighbor a little bit on the cool side, but never, ever any problems with all this that's going on here. My two sons went through the school system, they live here. They've had no issues. They have children that are in the schools right now, and they have no issues.
Can you just respond to the board?
I'm sorry.
No problem.
I didn't know. I just don't understand the need for this at all when it's already known that we should respect each other's feelings, and there's no need for this document. That, to me, it's regulating speech. Who is going to describe or determine what is hate speech? Who is it? Whose definition is that? I mean, certainly no one should go around and hate anybody or talk meanly to anyone. I mean, I don't know where it's coming from. I've never had experienced anything like it in my life, so I don't know what's going on.
Other comments? Gentleman in the back?
Michael Giacalone, Orchard Park Drive. To the board, I'm pretty concerned about a group wanting to implement this document. They want to put some sort of opinion document within the town, and I think that that's trying to imply that everybody in the town has this opinion. They don't speak for me. I don't think they speak for anybody other than themselves in this town. And to imply that this is what Reading feels, I don't think is appropriate. There are people who won't feel the things that they feel in this document, and that's okay for them to not feel these things. It is not okay to say Reading now feels this, because these people that don't agree with it, are they supposed to be expelled from the town, expect to move, not be part of the community? If it's not a binding document, then I don't think it's something that we need to have. It's not a lawful document. Anything that they're concerned about in this document is already taken care of and addressed by the laws that we already have in place. You can't force someone to feel a particular way about anybody, and that's okay. But we already have laws in place to make sure the rights of those people are not infringed upon based upon these things. I feel that if something like this of any capacity is put in place within this town or for the town, it's going to lead to other things. Otherwise, what is the purpose of having it? There's got to be I can't see any valid reason for this Board of Selectmen to have spent the time they spent on this and still have to spend continuous time on this for something that won't provide any legal, lawful value. We already have these common things that's already been spoken by many people. It's just common stuff. You don't be cruel to people,
or you shouldn't be, but if someone doesn't want to like somebody, then you can't force that upon them. A proclamation is not going to change someone's opinion. And as much as I agree with the premise of what they feel, I don't agree with its implementation. And I wouldn't care what direction this is coming from. It could be any group, even if it's something I completely agree with, saying they speak for me, they don't. I haven't given anybody the authority to speak for me. And we've heard enough people in this town say that very same thing through the letters to the editor. We've all talked to people. It seems to be a split situation, those who think it's okay and those who don't. But as the Board of Selectmen, I look at you as the protector of my rights to not have this document put in place. I have a right to not have it in any way, shape, manner, or form. It doesn't exist. It doesn't need to exist. And it's up to you guys to protect my rights as someone who doesn't want this, even if I'm the only one. There are many instances of things that go on in this country of one person having an objection to something that everybody else wants or already does, and now all of a sudden it's gone because of one person. Well, I'm that one. You have an obligation to protect my rights not to have it.
Other comment, sir?
Well, I had quite a spiel prepared, but I think I'm just going to second what I just heard.
It's a pretty short speech.
I just want to take...
Before you go, anyone else who hasn't spoken once? Any of the first-timers? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
Teresa Wiggins. Oh, am I?
Yeah, go ahead, Teresa.
Thank you. Teresa Wiggins, 61 Terrace Park. I don't have anything prepared. I just would like to sort of speak from the heart on this, and that is to say that I personally haven't felt like people here have stated, I agree, I haven't felt anything has happened to me that is listed in this document. But it doesn't mean my neighbor hasn't. And for me, knowing that this is just a welcoming, sort of inclusive, aspirational document, I like it. And it doesn't mean that I'm legislated to act or believe or think or anything. I love my role as a U.S. citizen, and I know my rights. This is not infringing on my rights. This is just saying, like, if I met any one of the people sitting in this room at the new Cafe Nero, I would want to strike up a conversation and say hello because we're a community. And that's what this is about to be, just saying we're a community and we're inclusive. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other first-timers who haven't said anything thus far? Yes, ma'am.
So I'm Lori Hoden, and I live on Summer Ave. And I'd like to speak from the heart also, and thinking about, Mr. Giacalone was talking about what your role is as Board of Selectmen, as defending the rights of Reading citizens. So I think about our next generation and our young people, and what I think is really important is that the adults, especially the Board of Selectmen, who are leaders in our community, stand for our shared mission and common values. And so I think this policy is really very, it's not a policy, this document is very, the framers have worked hard to listen to your concerns, and I think the document as it stands is a reasonable, aspirational statement of core values that I believe are fundamental to our democracy. So I just want to appreciate again all the work that the signatories have put in place. And when I think about the role of local, state, and national government in terms of what our Constitution was written about, I think about what message do we want to send our young people. And I think that sends a good message to young
people. Any other first-timers? Haven't spoken yet? Yes, ma'am.
Beth Sherland, Summer Ave. I grew up in Reading. I'm married to a black man. I have never had discrimination towards me. I'm a white woman. I'm pretty lucky in that regard. My husband has been stopped by the police because he's black. I was in the car. He had to restrain me because I was so furious. We have a Muslim family that lives down the street from us. I've heard comments about them. Don't walk your dog on their lawn. They're Muslim. It's here. People may not see it. I don't see it. I know it's here. And anything that we can do to stop it, We're not telling anybody what to believe, we're not telling anybody how to feel, you can't do that, that's impossible. We're just saying, this is, as a town, we welcome everybody. And if there's something specific in this document that you disagree with, I'm sure these people would be happy to hear it, but I fully support this, and I think it harms nobody, and I can't even believe that anybody would be against it. It's a welcoming, beautiful document. It almost made me want to cry. I was so proud of these women for writing it. That's it.
Last one. Any other further comments? Sir?
In listening to people, what they say, you know, this is a welcoming document, welcoming town. You feel if this document's in place, you'll want to have coffee with people at the shop.
No.
I would hope that without it, you wouldn't feel I'm unapproachable now. And that, no.
You're supposed to address the board, right?
I know.
Okay.
So I'm sorry. You're right.
I'd like to respond.
So with that said, with all these things, listening to the thing that was posted online, there was a lot of things, opinion documents saying, this is what Reading feels. We feel this. We do this not because we have to, but because it is who we are and what we value. I don't know how they have developed the authority to decide what Reading values. There are people that are going to value a lot of different things. And if they want to uphold people's rights and things of that nature, they have to uphold people's rights not to hold the same values that they have. We will stand up to those who would seek to undermine the beliefs of human rights we hold dear. We condemn those words of acts, hate, and difference. Who's defining what these are? Who's setting the parameters? How do they all of a sudden have the authority to make that definition of what is hate for one person and not another? An attack on one will be an attack on all. That sounds pretty pretty aggressive, in my opinion. If they're trying to set a level of love and tolerance and all that, attack is probably something pretty powerful statement in this. We are entirely and enthusiastically united. People are not entirely and enthusiastically united about this opinion document. It's creating a divide. I said in my letter before, what they're trying to achieve is not what's happening. They're achieving the opposite of people who are feeling, differently about this. It's something that they're trying to impose their beliefs on other people. I may not disagree with some of those things. I live in a pretty diverse neighborhood. We've got a lot of things in my neighborhood, and I'm not going to say what we have and we don't have, because that's their own business to disclose what these, what they are. But we got it all. We don't need this type of a document to define what this town is. It's a very welcoming town. People are trying to get in here. I don't see people not coming to Reading. So to put this type of document in place, and not wanting it does not make you a bad person. It makes you not want this type of thing imposed upon you to say it's your opinion when it may not be.
Thank you. It's 9:30, and I promised that I would hold us to that hour. Gina,
I was waiting so patiently.
Come on, you let him go twice.
Yeah, that's true.
Come on.
And he talks on.
I'll give you 30 seconds.
The drafters wanted to... I'm going to put this in a more formal letter with lots of time. We have a lot of timeline issues about things that happened, and it goes to the sort of what I started with, the communication between volunteers and the board, communication between the volunteers and the town management, and just wanted to let folks know that during the course of our subcommittee meetings, and I understand now that I guess it wasn't our right to see the town council's opinion, maybe that's where the divide was, but as the chairman directed the subcommittee to work on this, we thought it would be useful for us to see town council's opinion during the subcommittee meetings. And I just wanted to get on the record that we had asked to see that several times before the subcommittee met. We asked for it during the subcommittee meetings. It was not...
The reason it couldn't be made available is none of the rest of the board had seen it. The deliberative body that asked for it couldn't see it because it hadn't been convened. I can't hand something to the public. The rest of the board hasn't had a chance to see it. The reason we're taking this deliberately slow is exactly for the reasons you're pointing out, which is it needs to go slowly so that everything is heard, everything is reviewed. I think the timeline's helpful, but it's not dispositive to where we are today.
And so I just want to put on the record that I do understand that our town manager got town council's opinion on March 3rd, 2017, 3 days before our subcommittee convened. We met twice. We were never apprised that town council had read the document or had opined on the document. We met for 4.5 hours without the help of town council's opinion. And I think that Chairman Halsey's directive to us was to sort of figure out those First Amendment issues with the advice of town council to make a document that was acceptable to the board. And I did not find out, or none of us found out, until April 5th, when I wrote to the town manager and asked if there was, I heard Chairman Halsey reference an opinion from town council on RCTV. And so I wrote to the town manager and asked if there was one. And at that point on April 5th, we found out that town council had issued an opinion on March 3rd. So I wanted to put that timeline on the record. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, we're done. This group will meet again. Barry?
Before we move on to the next item, and maybe you're going to do this tonight, so I apologize. If you can just sort of lay out for the public's benefit as well as for our benefit, what's going to happen over the next 2 weeks if we do meet at our next meeting, what do we expect to accomplish there?
Correct.
And what's going to happen between now and then?
You remember we talked about a workshop. The workshop couldn't have occurred until we'd gotten the rest of the board caught up. Now that we're caught up, we'll have an intentional session to sit down and talk through what elements in the documents in front of us that we favor, what elements are problematic, what's the work product that we want to come out of this, and then what form should that work product take? Should it be a proclamation? Should it be an adjustment to policy? Should it be a resolution? What have you. So there's both a distillation process to take out what we all agree on, and then a discussion as to what format that would be, and that'll happen in our next meeting, I believe. Is that correct, Bob? Do you have that scheduled for
one of your next two meetings?
All right, so that would be in 2 weeks. Is there room in the meeting in 2 weeks?
Yeah, honestly, there's not a lot of room on the agenda on the 16th, but there's a wide open agenda May 30th.
I won't be here on the 16th, so
the 30th is fine.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
So is there anything that we would encourage the public to do? I'm sure they'll write more letters to the editor. But things, do we want to convene another working group, or are we just going to have it be us? I'm agnostic. I'm not suggesting.
My thought is you and I have gone, met with the group. Our opinions are written. The audio is online. Unless something dramatically different happens, I don't see how that's going to yield. Now that product's brought back to the board for us to decide what we're going to do with it. If anyone else has a separate view, I'm happy to listen. But Barry and I have spent 4.5 hours.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
May I just pass out?
Sure.
Some documents for you.
Thank you. Is this the ACLU?
Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
And it's also the most updated version of our resolution, as well as the first draft.
Is this the same as what's on the web, or is it a different?
Actually, a couple of things actually that you pointed to, based on community concerns.
So we'll call
this is like the third
some,
version.
We'll call
yeah,
this the third version.
Just,
okay.
Just simply delete it out, and actually, most of the things that you quoted
right.
Or that were quoted there.
Can you send electronic copy as well?
Out, so.
Could you send electrons?
No, we can.
Okay.
To
whom? To the town manager. And we now have video with real pictures, so that'll be better. Thank you all for coming. As I said, we'll meet again on the 30th, and there'll be a dedicated session for the board to deliberate next steps. Why don't we take a 3-minute recess? taxpayer citizen. All right, we've lost two members of the board.
And anyone taking minutes?
Yeah, why don't we, go ahead.
Yeah.
Grab you one.
Sure.
I used to bring it for him. He doesn't need it.
So you carry his water, is that the idea? Back to order. Next subject matter is the discussion of the Human Relations Advisory Subcommittee sunset. As I think most of you know, the HRC is due to sunset on June 30th of this year. There is, that current term was, I believe, a two-year term, and charged with, one of the primary goals was to determine what form the group would like to consider itself governed by or organized by, with the two examples being as an advisory committee, continuing as an advisory committee to the Board of Selectmen, or as an independent entity. By way of an example of the first, there's a Wakefield document in our package tonight. I won't go far in for it, but Town of Wakefield has a what I'd call a governing document, or at least a description document about how that board interacts with both town government and the schools. That's an example of the first instance where an advisory group would continue under the town. Because I don't personally believe there's enough time between now and the end of June to both conduct this conversation, complete it, and move to whatever comes next, I'm of the opinion we should propose for a 60-day extension to the existing sunset date and request that the Human Relations Committee come before us between now and that date, preferably before the end of July, again, allowing 30 days for any transition if necessary, or further extension, and report back what form of organization they care to be operating under for the next term. That's the only subject matter I think before us is extending this for 60 days. That would take it through August 30th, 2017. That make sense? Questions?
I think it's a fair and balanced approach. Give everybody time to.
There just isn't enough time to do it. We're starting May. We've got two full agendas. It happens in June, and then we're jammed. So this is more just giving it more runway. Okay. Questions from the public? Linda.
And this new officer still being the road. I'm just wondering. So I did not realize I was then chair. I'm now vice chair of the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
Right.
And I did not realize that we were restricted in structure to only an advisory or as an independent entity. So I'm just wondering if you can say a little more about that, because that will, that we weren't working under that assumption that it could only be one or the other.
My understanding 2 years ago when we, and I didn't bother to go back and look, but my understanding is when the two-year term was issued, that the question of what form it would take was the primary goal for the 2 years. Whether
yes.
to continue as an advisory committee or to become independent. And the advisory committee could have some variability within it. Wakefield's is an example. And there might be something that's uniquely Reading. But the real question is, do you want to continue as an advisory group to the Board of Selectmen, or do you care to become independent?
So that was not my understanding in terms of the limitations. And Chair Halsey had clarified that being an independent entity was only one example of what we could become, and I might be misquoting you, but that was only one example of what we could become, so we should go out and research, which is why we did research Arlington, Melrose, Wakefield and other communities, and have people that are willing to come, have come and talk to us. We also talk to Winchester. So there are many different models out there. I attend the Massachusetts Association of Human Rights Commissions meeting every month, and there are lots of different models out there, not just advisory or independent. And so I just want to clarify that we still have that leeway to find and propose what the best structure we think is and what we would advise our structure to be, as opposed to be deciding between one or the other.
So a couple things. It's now May 2nd, and the original sunset date is June 30th. So for that discussion to complete, obviously we don't have enough time. If you were to come back immediately, you'd have a range of options. There just isn't enough time in 6 weeks to go through and decide the path forward. So one of the reasons for the extension is simply that, to give you more time to report out. Barry?
Mr. Chair, my recollection of how we resolved this was that our instructions were to go and come back and tell us what you want to do. I didn't think we were putting sort of a four corners around it. And just to give an example, I mean, the Wakefield model, which has been talked about a lot, is neither independent nor under the Board of Selectmen. It's a joint organization of the Board of Selectmen and the school committee. So I would like to kind of leave it a little open for them to kind of do the work and come back to us and not have it pigeonholed this or that, but to come back and say, you know, this is the research that we've done, this is how we think we'd like to do it, and then have the discussion accordingly.
We can do that. I think that it's not just a matter of what the committee itself wants to be when it returns, but also what this board sees it as being.
But we're looking for their recommendation.
We're certainly looking for their inputs, but ultimately it's this board's decision. John?
So let's just, as a point of clarification, when this committee was extended 2 years, I wasn't the chairman. Okay, so let's just start there. And then we go along with the idea that, you know, I think, you know, Barry makes a point that, and I have along the way made a point also as well, to say it is important to understand what it is that our volunteer group is advising us they would like to be. And then, to your point, John, we could look at those options. We've heard about a commission. We know about an advisory board. We certainly understand and have examples of local peer communities who have independent nonprofits, you know, that operate in many ways, you know, kind of at their own pleasure. So there's a whole spectrum of things that we've heard about. But make no mistake that 2 years ago, or actually a little longer than 2 years ago, the discussion was, as sunsetting was coming into play, was no, we won't sunset the committee. Let's take a 2 year ramp here to be able to look at this thing and hear from the volunteers who have been working on this committee how they'd like to go forward. So that's kind of the way, from a historic standpoint, that is what happened. Okay, and at the time, it was pretty much, we're looking at two options. So I think to your point, that was the genesis of the extension of this committee. Since that time, I think Barry makes a good point that maybe there's other options, but then when all said and done, this is an advisory committee right to the Board of Selectmen, and we'll have to make that decision based on the input. But I think we're spinning our wheels here tonight. We need to definitely give them more time.
Right.
No question about that. I think that's the issue at hand here.
Correct. The only discussion tonight is the addition of time. I think it's a...
Yes, Bob.
With all due respect, the selectmen have certain authority, but if it's to take the board outside of under the selectmen and do something else within the town government or schools, they don't have the authority alone to do that. So there's a different path forward for that. You know, if the HREC wants to remain under the selectmen with different rules and regulations, that's entirely up to the board. But if it wishes to do something else that's dramatically different, in other words, not under the selectmen and not independent, there will be a different path forward. I don't know what it is because I don't know what the structure could be. But just to make clear, with all due respect, the selectmen have a limit on what the authority they have.
Yeah, I mean, it may require a bylaw.
It may, right.
Which, now you're talking about town meeting and the two-thirds, you know, acceptance at that point. So I think tonight, the issue is simple. There's, hasn't been adequate time to come to a place, let's extend the time.
Right, it's my hope that by now, the conversations would have happened in earnest and would be back third, you know, you'd be on, within the last couple of weeks of conversation. That hasn't happened. It's been communications, but we're nowhere near started. That's the reason for the extension, I think. Dan?
Mr. Chair, I'd like to ask Linda, if you feel that a two-month extension is adequate, do you need more time?
I was actually going to say that we could use more time.
Okay.
It's not that we didn't prepare. We did come and propose a possibility, but there was miscommunication about what the expectations were for that meeting. And so we were just in, the two groups were in very different places. So we have, in good faith, investigated Wakefield.
Right.
We have two commissioners that have been unbelievably helpful and informative. And I think that 2 months, if we have it done in 2 months, that's great. But as you're saying, Mr. Ensminger, I don't know that 2 months is enough, because we're all very busy trying to do the right thing in adequate research. There are things that we'd love to do, having, we've had offers from police chiefs or people that are on human rights commissions to come and speak to us, including the selectmen. It would be wonderful if we could plan in some of those opportunities. And I don't think those can happen in 2 months.
Just to be.
Because the goal was that you would be, what I heard said after our presentation was that you wanted to be educated along with us. You wanted us to present to you the options. And so one of the ways to do that is to bring people who are in human rights organizations to speak to all of us. And so I don't think 2 months is going to be enough. If we're serious about working this out, it would be great if we had more time.
So two thoughts. Again, this is 2 months at the extension after 2 years, and I understand we may not have made progress. The second is, I think the two questions are the form of governance and the scope of authority. Mm-hmm. And they're not unrelated. The scope of form of governance, I think the polls are the two that we described earlier, independent or as an advisory committee. And then in terms of the scope, I think the scope of authority, that's probably where the larger conversation is going to be, because we haven't had an expansive group, and there's a bunch of aspects to a large active group that aren't the case with a peer advisory group. But I'm open to a suggestion of a longer time frame. What would be reasonable in the board's mind?
Well,
given? Yes, John.
I mean, you've got a proposal at 60 days, which takes it 90 days out from now.
Correct.
And nothing stops us at that time.
No, it takes it 120 days out. We are at the beginning of May. This is the end
right.
of June. That takes it to the end of August.
So it takes you out 4 months. Hmm. You're set to sunset on June 30th.
Correct.
All right.
What we're talking about is extending that, which is 60 days away. We're talking about extending that
Correct.
Another 60 days. Mm-hmm. And let's see where we are.
It takes you up to the first of
I think at a certain point, you know, if you kind of put a fence around this thing and go, come on, let's try to, let's all work together and try to get to resolution with a timeline that, we set a two-year timeline. That didn't work out so well for us.
Well, you want task tension to get something done.
That's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes,
Bob
Dan.
When does the warrant close for 12 town meetings in September?
In September.
What if we were extended another 30 days beyond the 60? And that would cover the closing of the warrant.
You know,
if that's what it takes, we can also do it at that point to see if it's necessary.
If
so
it's
rather than dispense it tonight, but I'm open to the prospect if we need it.
I'm open to that too.
Let's make the call then and see where we end up.
I go either way.
That would be my opinion on that, is that if we get to the 1st of August and we've got something, great.
Exactly.
If we need 30 days, now we're going to really be.
Yeah.
Now we're if something's going to need to go to town meeting.
Yeah.
We're going to probably have to, when vacation season is still going on,
heat this thing up.
Why would we have to go to town meeting?
I'm not.
I don't know.
If it's a bylaw change.
I think all they're saying is if.
If they wanted. You're saying an if.
Let's say if they wanted a joint custody between the schools and us, that would have to go.
As Bob points out, I mean, there's only certain things within our purview. I mean, we can't wave a magic wand to just do whatever we want.
I don't think there's any more science than that, so.
Just remember my knee-high by the 4th of July rules.
Right.
Yes. I would.
As high as an elephant's eye?
I would support a motion tonight for a 60-day extension, which puts us 120 days out from tonight.
From tonight, right.
And then also, I haven't checked the list, but, you know, we have a liaison now, or I know Kevin was the liaison, and I don't have to decide that later, but I just think that, you know, that we should be, just don't wait 4 months for us to kind of know what's going on, but for us to, our liaison, whoever that person may be. Is it me?
No, it's a.
Oh. to work.
I agree, Barry. That's the intention here, is task tension. After 2 years, we're not as far as long as I think we ought to be for 2 years. I think we can make up some of that time, and I'm more than willing to extend the a suggestion even further if progress has been made, so.
There's more further discussion.
And if we need 2 liaisons to do more work, that's fine.
If it turns out that's fine as well. Any other questions from the board?
No.
Okay, Mr. Secretary, do you have a motion?
I do. Move that the Board of Selectmen extend the term of the Human Relations Advisory Committee to August 30, 2017.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? 5-0. Thank you very much. Let's see, the only other topic, 9:30, we're now 25 minutes behind. Board liaison assignments, well, it's with a big crowd, it's tough. Thank you, everybody, for coming out.
Thanks.
Give it 2 minutes. We'll take a 2-minute recess.
Yeah, sure.
Assignments were sent out after receiving inputs from four, and I did my best job, Andy, to assign you to both things. I thought you could make ground up. I think you're going to have a lot with the Historical District Commission. Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of activity going on with the Criterion and activity over in the Historic District Commission.
Okay.
So be careful what you wish for, but you're going to be very busy.
Looks like the mask is intact.
The only I think we put good people vote.
Yeah,
I think you have two. So
the only sort of thing that was near and dear to my heart, and where I'm sort of already up to speed, is the Board of Health, because mm-hmm. of my scientific criteria, you know, education, and what I do for a living, and what I did on the board for a number of years. So that would be, and I'd kind of like to see where that group goes. I know the personnel, I know the members. It wouldn't be very. I would enjoy doing it.
So when you sent your list in, did you prioritize that?
That was one of the first ones I sent. Yeah.
So your list got in?
Yeah, Saturday.
List got in after.
After it was done.
That was the only thing I felt.
I think the feedback from the health agent discussions that we're having is that group is undergoing a bunch of conversation. And actually, I think I'd actually like a little bit of air. And as a former member, I think I want to maybe increase that distance just to let that group reform itself into whatever it's going to be in the next round. There's nothing wrong with it, but sometimes a change of leadership, you got to give them some time and some distance. So.
Okay.
Any other comments? If not,
I was happy with mine.
Go forth and multiply, gentlemen.
Yeah. The other piece too is that, you know, we're all sort of ministers without portfolio.
There's nothing stopping
you. At the schools.
Not a potentiary without.
Or Andy, if there's something that they're talking about at the Board of Health that you have an interest in.
I'm still reeling from Bob's comment that we don't have unlimited powers.
Mm. No, you don't.
But I'll get over it.
Right.
I can occasionally see through lead, though.
OK. Okay, so that's the liaison assignments. We have approval of minutes from April 20th, 2017. Do we have a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen, move to approve the minutes of April 20th, 2017 as amended.
Okay, this was the meeting with the Thursday night we were in the,
right.
Yeah. The library.
I only had one, when there was only one actually important mix-up, probably because I was on the phone, and that was the Human Relations Advisory Committee is short on bodies, not the, probably a poor choice of your words, but not the cemetery trustees. So the cemetery trustees have
Where's that? Where's
the cemetery trustees? They're never short on bodies.
Where's that in the document?
It was in the beginning.
Did I really say?
Lord, of course now I help. Oh, here it goes. On page two, about three quarters of the way down, not quite, just under John Arena echoed.
Yeah.
Andrew Friedman noted that he attended the cemetery trustees meeting and they have a few members out of action. So that's actually the HRAC had a few members out of action. The cemetery trustees are good to go.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other changes, gentlemen?
That's all I had.
Okay, we have a motion. Seconded?
Second.
All those in favor of the minutes as amended, 5-0. And we have a short executive session tonight.
Chairman, move to go.
I'm sorry, Bob.
Can I just ask if any non-liaisons are going to attend the meeting? Please let me know if you know in advance, just so I can post you if that means they are.
We don't want that.
You know, when you all independently decided to go to a meeting, it's understandable, but.
Right. What do we do, draw straws at that point?
And we.
There's no reason not to go, but we just need.
Roll the dice, and you need. Generally, 3 days notice to be saved.
So no ahead of time. Yeah. No ahead of time.
Although, if we're not opining, that's.
That's true.
Why are you not deliberating?
But not deliberating.
For some of us, that is very difficult, like myself. Yes.
I haven't heard that word used so much.
Any other comments before we read the motion?
Move to go into executive session, if there are none, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and approval of minutes, and the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the body, and not to reconvene in open session.
This is a roll call vote, gentlemen, so John Halsey.
I'll second that. First.
We have a second. John Halsey?
Yes.
Barry Berman?
Yes.
John Arena, yes. Dan?
Yes.
Andrew?
Yes.
We are adjourned.
Thank you.